organized by Government College of Engineering and Ceramic Technology in collaboration with School of Mobile Computing, Jadavpur University. In this session, we have the pleasure of having with us Professor Chiranjeev Bhattacharya, Honorable Pro Vice Chancellor, Jadavpur University, Professor Somokanti Ghosh, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur, Professor Sharbani Roy, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Jadavpur University, and Professor Krishnendu Chakraborty, Principal, Government College of Engineering and Ceramic Technology. Now, I would invite Professor Krishnendu Chakraborty, Principal, Government College of Engineering and Ceramic Technology, to give the welcome address. Sir, please.
Good afternoon. I am very happy to be present in this third webinar of the series Future Generation Computing and Application. And today's theme is Cloud Computing. And this is being done in collaboration with School of Mobile Computing and Communication, Jadavpur University, and Government College of Engineering and Ceramic Technology. In this webinar, I welcome Professor Chiranjeev Bhattacharya, Honorable Pro Vice Chancellor, Jadavpur University, as chief guest, and today's eminent speakers, Professor Sharbani Roy of Jadavpur University, Professor Somokanti Ghosh of IIT Kharagpur. I also express my heartfelt thanks to Professor Arpita Sarkar, Professor Kingshuk Chatterjee, Professor Paramita De. They are the coordinator of this webinar that is being organized today. Now, after 24th of March, the day lockdown was declared, we have passed more than 6 months. And in this 6 months, we have learned many things. We have unlearned many things. We have adopted a new lifestyle of ourselves and new technique of teaching learning process. As a new lifestyle, wearing mask has become a must for everybody of us. Digital platform for teaching learning process has become must for everybody of us. Many of us, probably prior to 24th of March, we were a little bit adverse to the use of teaching learning digital platform for teaching learning process, but the nature or situation has compelled us to do this. Gradually, we are becoming at home in this particular system. Processes are going on online platform. And yesterday night, we had a meeting to assess the thing that we are doing with our faculties and students. Now, many faculty discussed about the advantages of this digital platform that we have adopted for our teaching learning process. Now, this webinar is also one of the advantages of this particular process. Generally, to hold a workshop or a seminar, it was a very difficult task for any institution in terms of logistics, in terms of conveyance, in terms of getting experts from different fields in a particular location. Similarly, for training of people also. But nowadays, in a very short notice, in the comfort of home, we can be present in this type of workshop, seminar, or webinar, and we can express ourselves, and those who are the participants, they can enrich themselves for this particular system. So that way, it is very, very useful, and it has been noticed that attendance of students in a class has been increased, and I have seen, not only in West Bengal, in other states also, that there is a practice that final year students, they generally do not come to the institute. The attendance in a class is very poor, but in this online classes, as it has been reported, that now attendance is more than 90% in a class. What we feel that the student, they need not commute, they can stay at their home, they can utilize the commuting time for their other activities. So this platform has become very popular for them also. Now, as today's theme is cloud computing, I am not an expert of this particular field. As a general person, as I know that this cloud computing is a delivery of different services for internet, and internet has become a part of our lifestyle. Interestingly, today my house, the broadband service of BSNL is out of order. I went to Jio shop, I brought a dongle, and today I am using this particular bus with Jio dongle. That means how it has become important in your life. So cloud computing is giving us a facility to connect or use all the facility available in the net. I connect my computer to the net and I can have all the accesses, all the computing, all the data that I need. Interestingly, the Google Drive that we use every day, it is also a personal cloud storage service from Google. The movie we see from Netflix, it is also running in Amazon's public cloud. So there are an infinite number of applications of cloud computing. We are the users of that. On today's webinar, probably we'll be able to understand the basics and more detail about this cloud computing. Now, I'll be very happily waiting to know a little more on this. And I welcome all participants of my faculties to this particular webinar. And I wish that whenever we go home after this webinar, we enrich ourselves with knowledge that is received from them. With this, I welcome you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your interesting and kind words. Now, I would invite Professor Chiranjeev Bhattacharya, Honorable Pro Vice Chancellor, Jadavpur University, to give the keynote address. Sir, please.
So, thank you very much, first of all, the Kinshuk Chatterjee. So, sir, thank you very much. And I thank all the organizers of the School of Mobile Computing, Paramita Dey, Paul Peter, and others who are there, particularly associated in organizing this particular webinar on the future generation of computing. So I think it is the second series. In fact, in the last one also I attended for a very short duration. Today also I was in another meeting. I've gone out of that particular meeting to attend this particular webinar, and I have to join that particular meeting once again. So that happened in the last day also, probably on 18 September, that particular meeting was organized, most likely, I'm not sure of that particular date. So it's really very good. Nowadays, we are basically getting accustomed to this particular new culture of webinar, that is basically nothing but the online conference. As Professor Krishnendu Chakraborty has already highlighted, that Krishnendu Chakraborty of Government College of Engineering and Ceramic Technology, he has already highlighted that nowadays organizing a webinar is comparatively easier than the physical organization of a conference, because that involves a lot of cost, particularly bringing the expert, providing accommodations, and particularly the venue management. All these things are quite complicated. Now, this particular thing has made the situation quite easy, in fact, for all of us to organize this sort of webinar that is nothing but an online conference. Anybody can see at any place, nationally or even on the international perspective also, and he or she can attend this particular webinar. So it is nothing but the outcome of the digital technology, which made these things very simple. Nowadays, as Professor Chakraborty has highlighted, that everybody, we are using the digital technology, particularly during this COVID-19 pandemic. Now, the teaching learning process, or the learning management system, LMS, as it is called nowadays, it is completely relying on the digital technology. Now, at Jadavpur University also, we are having a strong mindset. Everybody is aware of that, because we generally like to follow the traditional methodology. But in these particular circumstances, definitely, now also we need to change ourselves. We have to adapt to the modern technologies, and the modern teaching learning processes. So accordingly, at Jadavpur University also we have started taking classes in the online mode. But truly speaking, the non-contact distance mode using the digital platform. So this is the terminology that we are using, quote unquote. Non-contact distance mode classes using digital platform. It is not the real-time online classes in some cases, particularly where the students are expressing their inability to join the real-time online classes because of the non-ability of good quality internet or the smart device which one should possess to attend these sort of classes. So this is very important. The internet services should be very good, which is not up to the mark in many places. In fact, I am also facing a lot of problem. I am attending every day lots of their online meetings, online conferences, etc. I am facing lots of problem because of that. I have taken a particular broadband connection also very recently using the OFC, the optical fiber online broadband just connection from a service provider. So still with that also the situation is not very good, not up to the mark. Obviously the connectivity issues are definitely there. The seamless connectivity is a very big issue, particularly for attending the real-time online classes. So at Jadavpur University also we are taking advantage of the cloud-based storage. That is nothing but the Google Drive. We have procured the G Suite and we are taking advantage of the Google Drive, which is built in the G Suite module itself. So basically whatever it is, some sort of repository concept. So whatever the classes we are taking, it may be the real-time online or some sort of other mode of online classes, we are just uploading all the contents to the repository itself so that the student can download from that particular repository as per their convenience when they will have the good connectivity. Now this is another thing, particularly this particular conference is the theme is the cloud computing. So cloud computing is particular the concept that where we are using the computational power of a strong multi-core server sitting remotely at our home. So that particular connection may be through the SSH tunneling, that is the secure shell tunneling, which is very common nowadays, particularly to provide the security of accessing that particular computational server through internet using firewall or some other medium. So that particular thing, I'm not going into the technical details because I'm not belonging to that particular subject area. My daughter is studying the computer science and engineering. From her, actually, I got some information about some terminologies and etc. So I'm a little bit acquainted with some different terminologies of the modern computer science. So basically the thing is that it is a very good concept. At Jadavpur University also we have installed a very high-end server at the technology Bhavan. But I think that is also a multi-core computer, the server what we have installed and procured under the TIQUIT program. And that is also our objective, was that we can share its computational ability among all the participants, among all the staffs or the students of the Jadavpur University through our LAN, that is the local area network, sitting at the Jadavpur University. We are exploring whether we can just render this service on the off-campus basis also using this particular SSH tunneling concept. But that has not yet been developed. In fact, that facility we couldn't extend to the in-house user within the campus also because of some technical problem. But that particular server has been installed with this particular concept, keeping in mind that we should allow the cloud computing based on the computational power of that particular server. But it is not cloud, truly speaking, in that particular sense, because it is our in-campus server. There are several cloud computing concepts offered by the Microsoft as well as the Amazon cloud computing or something like that, Microsoft computing, that is also there. The Azure cloud is there. So these are basically the cloud computing concept, the completely the total cloud computing concept, where we are exploring the facilities of a high-end server, the computational server, and we are getting advantage of that particular server in terms of the computation. So suppose, particularly nowadays, AI-based or the machine learning-based computational require a lot of high computational effort because it requires a lot of computational effort. So in that particular case, if we can use that particular computational power of a high-end server situated at a remote distance through cloud, so that will give us a lot of advantage in terms of the computational time. The program that we may execute on our desktop or simple laptop that may require days of computing, which can be executed within half an hour or 1 hour or 2 hours if we use the cloud computing facilities and high-end server. So this is a very modern technology nowadays, and people are using this particular thing, particularly during this COVID-19 pandemic, when the people are forcibly confined to their homes because of this particular social distancing norms. They are, this particular concept can play a very big role nowadays. In fact, a lot of IT companies are now switching from to this particular WFH, that is the work from home concept. And what, if these IT companies are relying on the cloud computing features, because their employees situated at their home, they can access their server and they can do the needful regarding the computational need using this cloud computing concept. So this work from home concept is gradually spreading, and it may become permanent in some sectors also. It will continue even after the COVID-19 pandemic also. This WFH concept will continue, and in that particular case, this cloud computing will definitely get more of popularity in the coming days or in the coming year, and there will be much more development in terms of its use, accessibility, as well as in terms of features. So I don't want to continue very much. There are a lot of experts who will be able to speak on this particular aspects of the cloud computing. I definitely want to congratulate the School of Mobile Computing and their dynamic faculty members who are really doing very well by organizing this sort of webinar. I always encourage the faculty members of the Jadavpur University to organize webinar during this particular COVID-19 pandemic, because we are now not being able to organize the physical conference. So I always encourage, and it's really good that the School of Mobile Computing, the only technology school or even not a single department also, within this particular technology under FPT or FISL, they have organized this sort of webinar. The School of Mobile Computing is the only exception, and this is the second webinar I think they are organizing. Apart from another one is the Counseling Center, they have also organized two webinars. So it's really good. I encourage all the departments or the schools to organize this sort of webinar in a much greater number. Particularly the schools and the department, those are belonging to the technology faculty, they can get some financial help if necessary from the TPIP program, because you are all aware that we have got the extension of the TPIP program. The TPIP 3 was supposed to terminate on 30th September, but we have got the extension up to the 31st March. So definitely, if you wish, you can apply for some fund. In some cases, if you require some fund in organizing this webinar or something like that. So I definitely congratulate the School of Mobile Computing, and I welcome all the delegates, all the expert members who will speak on this particular webinar. So with this, I want to conclude. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir, for your interesting words and views. This concludes the inaugural session. We once again thank Professor Chiranjeev Bhattacharya, Honorable Pro Vice Chancellor, Jadavpur University, and Professor Krishnendu Chakraborty, Principal, Government College of Engineering and Ceramic Technology. We will now begin the first talk on Migration Techniques in Cloud, Overview and Research Challenges by Professor Sharbani Roy. Professor Sharbani Roy is a professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Jadavpur University. She received her PhD degree in engineering from Jadavpur University in 2008. She was awarded Fulbright Nehru Senior Research Fellowship in 2013-14 and joined the research program at University of North Carolina, Charlotte, USA. She is a gold medalist both in UG level. Her research interests include cloud computing, wireless sensor networks, IoT, social network analysts, and data science. She co-authored more than 130 research papers in international conference proceedings and journals. She has been involved in technical program committees, organizing committees for many international conferences, and also acted as a reviewer for many international conferences and journals. She is a senior member of IEEE. I would like to invite Professor Sharmari Roy to begin her talk. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Kingshuk. Thank you for nice introduction. So I can start my talk. For saving the network bandwidth, I would like to off the video and going to the main slide presentation. So I'm audible, right?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Thank you. Can you see the screen? Can you see the presentation?
Yes, the presentation is visible now.
Okay, thank you. So so the title of my talk is Migration Techniques in Cloud, Overview and Research Challenges. Before going to discuss this particular topic, I would like to request the participants to, if they have any questions regarding any of the topics that I'd like to cover here, they can put their questions in the chat box, and I will visit the chat box and will try to answer those questions. So the topic is migration techniques in cloud. But before going to discuss about what is migration technique exactly and what are its research challenges, I will highlight some of the basics of cloud computing. So let me start with a very simple introduction of cloud computing and its essential features or characteristics. If we do a little Google search on cloud computing, we will find several definitions of cloud computing available in online platform. Here I prefer one definition by NIST, National Institute of Standards and Technologies. According to that NIST, the cloud computing is defined as a model for enabling ubiquitous, convenient, on-demand network access to a shared pool of configurable computing resources, where resources could be anything like computation resources, the processor, storage, memory, network, server, applications, or in short, any kind of services that can be rapidly provisioned and released with minimal management effort or service provider interaction. So if you look at this particular definition, you will see that there are several keywords. Let me explain these keywords. So among this, I will pick the first keyword, that is the shared pool of resources. What is exactly this shared pool of resources? We all heard about this data centers, right? Or different type of cloud service providers like Amazon, Microsoft, or IBM Cloud, or Google Cloud Platform. These are the giant companies. They are actually very popular, known cloud service providers. So what they have different type of data centers with them, located in different geographical locations. So these data centers are you can visualize these data centers as some place where there is this resources are available. So resources means here, very specifically, we can think about some major resources like computation power or processors. We can think about the storage as resources, or we can think about network as resources, or data as resources, or applications, or services. So these are some resources which are available in these data centers. So when we are thinking about these resources available at data centers, we can visualize it as a pool of resources. So in this pool of resources, the important characteristics is that they can be shared. it is not dedicated. It can be shared. So the share resources can be shared. Shared among who? Shared among the users or the clients or among the different applications. It's not a dedicated resource. It's a kind of a pool of resources which can be shared. Second important keyword here is the configurable. Configurable computing resources. That means whatever resources are physically available on that pool of resources, it can be configured to fulfill the requirement of the clients. So the situation is client can submit some request for the resources. That resources could be anything. It could be a computation resource, it could be a storage resource or the data resource or network resource, anything. Based on that requirement of the client, these resources can be configured and can be available to the client. So this is the meaning of shared pool of configurable computing resources. Another important keyword here is that these resources can be rapidly provisioned. So what does it mean? Provisioning. Provisioning means the availability of the resources in very simple words. Now, let me give you one example. Suppose for some client, there is a requirement of some resource, say amount X. I'm not giving any unit to that. I'm just giving an abstract idea of provisioning. So X is the actual requirement of some resource. Now, suppose the client placed some demand for X plus. So X plus is actually greater than X. So why the client will do this kind of thing? Because when client is placing some demand for some particular resource, say the processor or storage, it has some idea about the requirement, right? And that idea probably built on top of some prediction or some analysis of the historical data. However, it is not always possible to predict accurately about that requirement. It's not always possible to keep the bound within the predicted value. To address this type of situations, what one can do? What can make some extra addition of the requirement? So X plus is like that. X plus is something more than actual requirement. And here, this is provided to the user. So this scenario is called the provisioning. X plus can be treated as an over-provisioning because the requirement is X and X plus is more than that. So it is called over-provisioning. Similarly, if there is something demanded like X minus, which is less than X, then X minus will be treated as under-provisioning. In cloud computing environment, the provisioning is also very important. Why it is important? Because we don't have any exact idea about the demand. Demand can vary with time. So it's a kind of a dynamic demand. To fulfill that requirement of dynamic demand or to address the challenges associated with the dynamic demand, provisioning concept is there. And provisioning could be over-provisioning or under-provisioning. And this overall scenario of provisioning can be released and managed very, very easily in cloud computing environment that is provided by the service provider. And as we know, this cloud computing environment can be accessed from remote location. It is providing on-demand access to the services. So when it is on-demand, if we have to understand this concept of on-demand, it is not a static demand, it is not a fixed demand. Whenever there is a demand, you can place that request to the service provider and service providers will fulfill that request. That is the basic criteria. And it's quite obvious in real scenarios that there will be a change in this demands with respect to time. It may increase, it may decrease, depending upon the actual demanding scenario. Accessing cloud computing facilities or the services associated with cloud environment are very convenient. Why it is very convenient? Now, if we look at our day-to-day life, we all are using several type of cloud applications, like starting from the Google Drive, OneDrive, or Dropbox, or just name different type of applications, those which are built on top of cloud environment, which are taking the power of cloud environment for providing services to the user or clients. We have a lot of experience in accessing this type of services. Moreover, we are using smartphone, and almost every smartphone companies are providing their own cloud storage backup to them. For example, suppose in your phone you are getting, say, 8 GB cloud storage. So that is the cloud storage service provided to you, and you don't need to bother about how to access that storage service or how to place your data in the storage service or how to manage all these things. You just take the data and you just need to just click one button there. You have to agree with the contract between the service provider and the smartphone, and everything will be automatically done. If there is a data stored in your phone, and if the phone storage is not sufficient in doing that, it automatically pushed the data to the cloud service. So it's very convenient. We are getting a very, very easy to go kind of services from this cloud computing service provider. And the overall thing is enabling this ubiquitous access from anywhere, any place, anytime. We can get the access of this type of services, and definitely with the help of internet or a network access things. So this is how we can visualize the cloud computing environment. And if we pick the main characteristics of cloud computing, then definitely there will be this concept of on-demand self-service that I have discussed, that what is actually on-demand service. Whenever there is any requirement, we can provide that request to the service provider and we can get that. Here, two things are important: that the provisioning of the service, it could be over-provisioning, sometimes it is under-provisioning. If it is under-provisioning, the users may need to suffer with the performance degradation. If it is over-provisioning, then there will be very poor utilization of resources. So when I'm saying this on-demand service, with the provisioning concept associated with this on-demand service, it also comes with several challenges. Like in under provisioning, there is a challenge of performance degradation. When it is over provisioning, there is this challenge of poor resource utilization. So these are the characteristics, right? But along with them, there are several challenges associated. Then the next one is the broad network access. Without the network access, it's not possible to get this cloud services so easily, so ubiquitously in reality. Then, as I told you, it's nothing but this concept of resource pooling. So resources are pooled. It's a shared pool of resources. Everyone in terms of the applications or the clients can access that resource. And the whole thing about this providing services so efficiently is actually based on this concept of resource pooling. Next, it comes this rapid elasticity. Resources can be joined, resources can be removed from this pool of resources dynamically. So this dynamicity, handling this dynamicity, handling the challenges associated with the dynamicity, nicely maintained by the cloud computing service providers, and it is able to provide rapid elasticity, because the elasticity is again related with the demand of the services. So if there is a high demand of services, you need to increase the power. If there is a low demand of services, you need to decrease the power. And finally, the whole concept of this cloud computing is based on this pay and use model. So you have to pay for whatever you have used. So it's a measured service or the meter service. Services are metered. Based on this metering concept, the amount that you have to pay. So these are actually the some of the important characteristics of cloud computing. So if you have any question here. Okay. So now moving forward, I will talk about some of the service models. Before going to discuss about the service model, let me give you some scenario where there is no cloud, say. So just to assume a scenario where the cloud computing is not available. What happened without the cloud computing? So suppose we have an organization and a new organization or an old organization for the requirement of its business or requirement of that organization, it is thinking about some of the infrastructure building. Here, infrastructure building, mainly the computational or storage infrastructure building. So how one organization can progress on this particular problem? So initially, that organization will do some study on the demand, what type of demands can be there in future. So if you look at this particular figure, you can see that there is a time axis, that is the x-axis. So here this dotted line is showing the predicted demand. So basically that organization did some study on the historical data and fitted it with a suitable model, and according to this particular diagram it seems that it will be a linear model and with time the demand will be increased. So based on this predicted demand, what they can do, they can build their infrastructure. And for building that infrastructure, which is showing here, the cost on or capital expense on that infrastructure building is in the y-axis. So for this type of predicted demand, they can invest some money there. Now, next, in reality, it is very difficult or it's not that obvious of getting this type of linear kind of demand. So demand could increase or demand could decrease with time. So this red line here, or red line, is showing the actual demand in real scenario. So here, if you look at this this particular overlapping of the red and black curve, you can easily figure out that there are some situation when the available infrastructure is sufficient, and there are some situation where this available infrastructure is not sufficient. For example, this particular point is not sufficient. However, this particular section is sufficient. So there are several such instances in this case, that when the existing infrastructure is sufficient and sometimes it is not sufficient. So that is actually a problem for that organization. So how that organization will tackle this problem? The obvious solution is scale-up approach. That means with time it will follow the trend, and it can experience that sometimes there is a high demand which is not fulfilled by the existing infrastructure. So what it can do after some period of time, for example here, after some period of time it will increase the infrastructure. So for increasing the infrastructure power, it need to involve a lot of capital expensive here. So now the infrastructure is that. So it is not following the linear diagram. So there is a hike in the infrastructure. Now again, if we go back to the real scenario, so here in this real scenario, now there is no situation where, I mean, within this cap, there is no situation where the organization failed to fulfill the requirement, because all are within the current infrastructure support. But there are several situations when the resources are not properly utilized. So if you look at this particular section, in this section demand is very low, it's not very high, so the resources available are not properly utilized in this section, right? So resource utilization is not good, a lot of expenses already involved here. Two problems we can experience in this case. And this can follow up, because with time the requirement can increase and demand can increase and the organization can push its capacity here. And this is one approach. Another approach is it can reduce the time scanning window, and can provide scale out approach, and can expense more on building infrastructure within a small period of time. So if you look at this green dotted line and the blue dotted line, what you can figure out that they will be, both are pretty much similar, but the investment and the utilization of the resources, this ratio can be varied between these two. Maybe the green one give you better performance in respect to that ratio, and the blue one maybe perform poorly. However, these two solutions are not good at all because in both the cases, there is this problem of poor resource utilization and high cost expenses. So how to address this problem? Now, if you look at this green one, green curve, green curve is actually the exact solution of this problem. Whenever there is an increase in the demand, it will provide the high demand. Whenever there is a decrease in the demand, it's scaled down. So this green one is kind of an automated scaling. So whenever there is a high demand, it is high. Whenever there's a low demand, it is high. It is low. So looking at this solution from two perspectives, one is the resource utilization and another is the cost. In both the perspective, the green one is giving the good solution or the more appropriate solution. And this is nothing but the cloud computing solution. So cloud is that type of environment where based on your requirement or based on your demand, we can scale up or scale down. And by doing that, we can achieve both good or better cost optimization solution as well as better resource utilization solution. Next, I will move towards the existing service models. So this one was initially, so two type of solutions are there. One is the on-premise solution and another one is the cloud solution. So if you look at the on-premise solution like this one, the first one, in the on-premise solution, the user or the subscriber or the customer need to take all the hassles, starting from the hardware to the operating system and the software application, everything. So if we think about the main layers of this computation environment, like starting from the networking, storage, server, virtualization environment, operating system, if any middleware or runtime environment required or application data, whatever, everything is under the control of the subscriber or the customer. So here the botheration is much in on-premise solution. It's not possible to scale up automatically. It's not possible to fulfill all the high and down demand requirements. Next comes the cloud solutions. In cloud, it is modeled as an X as service. So here, X could be anything. For example, X could be infrastructure, X could be platform, or X could be software. Like infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, or software as a service. So how these three things are different from each other? In infrastructure as a service, the cloud service providers, there are actually two parties. One is the service provider and another one is the service consumer or subscriber. So service provider is responsible for networking, storage, virtualization, server, etc. So this marked portion, the white portion marked here, is actually under the control of the service provider. And the rest part, that means operating system, middleware, runtime, application data, these layers will be taken by the subscriber or the consumer of that particular service provider. So in examples like infrastructure as a service, client only take that virtual machine instances from the service provider, and then it build its own it's load its own operating system there, its own middleware, its own runtime environment according to the requirement. It placed everything there, and then it can build its application and data. So for a responsibility point of view, in infrastructure as a service, it's taking only the infrastructure from the service provider, and the rest of the part is under the consideration of the consumer. Whereas in platform as a service, so some example of infrastructure as a service, like in Amazon EC2 is a good example of infrastructure as a service. Next comes this platform as a service. In platform as a service, from hardware to the system software, up to that is actually provided by the service provider. That means networking, storage, server, virtualization, operating system, middleware, everything is under the control of service provider. And the user or the subscriber or consumer is only bothered about the application and data. So it's the botheration in platform as service is much less in respect to the infrastructure as a service. And finally, there is some example of platform as a service is the different cloud computing, Google Cloud Computing platform, like developing cloud functions there. In Amazon Web Service, like Lambda function, developing Lambda functions, or building some machine learning applications there is a kind of a platform as a service. Or Hadoop, if you want to use the Hadoop as a service or Hadoop platform in distributed cloud computing environment, that is also a platform as a service. Then comes the software as a service. Now the everything is under the control of service provider, starting from the networking or the bottom layer of the hardware to the upper layer of the of the stack, that is application layer. Everything is under the control of the service provider itself, and we are only using that application. For example, Google Drive, Dropbox, these are some example of software as a service. So next is different type of deployment models. Different type of deployment models are there, majorly private cloud, community cloud, public cloud, and hybrid cloud. How they are different? Private cloud is something which is operated solely for a single organization, as Professor Chiranjeev given one example of our technology bhavan, where we have different type of servers available. So in that environment, if it is possible to build a cloud environment that can be accessed by the members of the university, and that could be accessed by the LAN, and within in-house the members will be able to access that, will be a good example of private cloud. So it may provide the on-premise service as well as off-premise services, depending upon its design and everything. But in private cloud, the outside that organization, it's not possible to access it. Next is the community cloud. In community cloud, it's shared by several entities or several organizations. For example, if Jadavpur University with the government engineering engineering college of ceramic, and if they jointly build some cloud computing environment with some other university, if it is possible, then that will be a case of community cloud, where different organization can take part, different people from different organization can access that. Then comes this public cloud. It's a very general available to all the publics, owned by a single organization, like the Amazon Web Service or Google Cloud platform, or Azure by Microsoft, or IBM cloud, like this. So these are the public cloud. Anyone can access the services, and anyone can get the services, but it is owned by a single organization. And then there is this concept of hybrid cloud, which is actually a combination of two or more private or community or public cloud. So if it is possible to combine this different deployment models, we can build a hybrid cloud also. Like Jadavpur University together with AWS, if it is possible to build a cloud, then it could be a hybrid cloud. Now, the basic concept behind this cloud computing and providing all these essential features is based on the concept of virtualization. This concept is not very new. This concept of virtualization is present from the time of mainframe systems, but in this era of cloud computing, it's hugely popular, because with this concept we can do different type of virtualization with the processor, with memory, with network, with storage, and because of that only it is possible to spread cloud computing environment so widely. So if we look at this particular figure of of this system, then we can see that there is some hardware resources like CPU, memory, network card, disk, and this on top of this hardware, there is an operating system and application is running. So it is giving an image of a single environment or single and a standalone system with a single operating system. And in this type of system, hardware and software are tightly coupled, there. An application crashes affect all. If there is anything wrong with this application, it will hamper the performance of the entire system. But the problem, the main problem with this type of system is that the utilization of the resources, because the application is using these resources, but the power of the resources may be more. It can handle or it can provide, it can accommodate more number of applications, but that is not possible in this type of scenario. So resource underutilization is the major problem with this scenario. To solve this problem, there is this concept of virtualization. So what happened here? Now there is one extra layer, which is a virtualization layer, and with the help of this virtualization layer, it is possible to provide different instances of the machines having the same resources like CPU, memory, network, and disk. So this is one. This one is one virtual machine, and this is another virtual machine having this instance of these resources. And on top of this virtual resources, there is one operating system layer, and on top of that operating system layer, there may run multiple number of applications. So just looking at this diagram, or just looking at this concept of multiplexing resources across this virtual machines can dictate that how nicely the resources can be utilized. So definitely the resource utilization is much better in this concept, and that is the key thing behind the cloud computing environment. So now some of the virtualization architectures, different type of virtualization architectures are there. Majorly it's a software based virtualization, and another one is the hardware based virtualization. In software based virtualization, you can see that there is a separate layer for hardware and host operating system. So these two things are same as in the standard devices. There's a hardware layer and the operating system, but on top of that, there is a virtual machine manager. So virtual machine manager, or VMM, is an extra layer on top of host operating system, which is doing all this virtualization and creating this virtual machines and taking this task of monitoring this virtual machine. So you can see that there are three virtual machines shown in this figure. It will be multiple number of virtual machines with different type of guest OS there. Like Windows, here it is using Linux, here it is using VMware ECX, and on top of that different applications can run. So in this way, this application is also utilizing this hardware, this application is also utilizing this hardware, and this application is also utilizing the same hardware, and it is possible because of the virtualization of this hardware, right? So here it is software-based virtual organization, where there is one host OS and there are several guest OS, and virtual machine manager lies on top of the host OS. Another virtualization technique is the hardware virtualization technique, where the hardware layer is separated and it is the part of the physical machine. So hardware layer is there, and there is no host OS. Actually, the host OS clubbed with the virtualization layer. So here both, I mean, this particular layer is nothing but the hypervisor, which is responsible of creating these virtual machines and responsible for the virtualization of the existing hardware or available hardware. So here you can also see that how this particular layer is managing the virtual, different type of virtual machines running on that system. Similarly, as I told you, this virtualization layer is nothing but the hypervisor. A different type of hypervisors are there. So based on that, this virtualization can be done. So now what are the challenges here? What are the challenges that need to be addressed? The first thing is the resource utilization. As I told you, there is a scenario where we have resources, but resources are not properly utilized. To improve the resource utilization, we can use this concept of virtualization, which can provide different type of virtual machines, and these virtual machines can be assigned to the clients based on their request to the VMs, and they can access those hardwares, and the utilization of the resources can be improved. So that is the basic idea about the resource utilization. But resource utilization is not only one challenge. Under resource utilization, there are several other research problems like load balancing. If you think about this cloud data centers, there are different physical machines or array of physical machines available, and different VMs are created over there, and they are allotted to the client based on their request and demand. But sometimes it may happen that the load of that physical machines are not balanced properly. So that is one important challenge under resource utilization, that is load balancing. If load is properly balanced, we can say that the resource utilization is also good. Next challenge is the fault tolerance. See, the hardware is prone to fault or prone to failure. It's not possible to avoid it completely at the hardware level. However, the system need to be robust enough to tackle the situations of fault or failures. So fault tolerance system is another very important aspect of this. And somehow, if the load is balanced, you can also partially address the fault tolerance. For example, let me give you one scenario. Suppose there are a number of physical machines, and among them, one machine is overloaded, is heavily loaded, and heavily loaded machine can generate heat, and then heat can cause a failure in that system. So if it is possible to balance the load among the physical machines, we can restrict it from being the overheated or heavily loaded scenario. And if it is possible to restrict it from that situation, we can also address some part of the fault tolerance. We can make it more fault tolerant, right? Because we will not allow it to be overloaded. So this way, these challenges are actually linked with each other in some way. Then there is this challenge of power or energy management. It is also related with this load balancing. If the physical machines are on, they are consuming energy. If it is overloaded, they are consuming more energy, creating more heat. And you know that somehow, if we can do the proper balancing of the load among the physical machines, we can switch off some of the physical machines, which can save energy there. So this way, energy management is related with the load balancing. Sorry. Then the other aspects like server upgradation, probably as one of the major essential characteristics of cloud computing is rapid elasticity. So to support that, upgradation of the server is quite obvious or quite required for handling the real-time scenarios. Another is the server consolidation. Consolidation is also linked with the load balancing and the energy management issue. Consolidation is something where we probably want to keep the virtual machines in physical machines so that or the placement of the virtual machines in the physical machines so that it is load balanced and energy efficient. So these are some of the resource challenges related with the resource utilization. And if we look at all these challenges, we can easily understand that with the help of migration, we can solve some part of these challenges. So VM migration could be a solution for addressing these challenges. To explain that, I would like to give you one example. If you look at this particular figure, you can see that there are two physical machines, physical machine A and another one is the physical machine B. And here in physical machine A, three virtual machines are running, and in physical machine B, only one virtual machine is running. So just looking at this scenario, we can say that the physical machine A is overloaded and B is it's slightly loaded. So here the assumption is that one physical machine can hold three virtual machines of that size. So what could be the solution? The solution is, if it is possible to move one VM from here to the physical machine B, like this. So here in this approach, where A is holding two VMs and B is holding another two VMs, this is much more balanced. So in this load balancing situation, we have to do this migration, right? So this is how migration is related with the load balancing thing. Similarly, if you think about another situation like here, where there are three physical machines A, B, and C, and in all these three physical machines, only one VMs are running. And if you think this from the power and energy management aspect, then three physical machines are on, but one physical machine is sufficient to run or hold this three VMs. So to make it more energy efficient, what you can do, you can migrate VM from A to C and this VM from B to C. So after migration, you may get this type of situation, and this is a very energy efficient situation, right? But this one is a load balance situation, but not energy efficient. And this one is the energy efficient situation. Here you can, after doing this migration, what you can do, you can simply switch off A and B. So that is the reason I'm saying that it is energy efficient situation. So what we are getting from this scenario is that there is no one solution that can capture all the challenges, can solve all the issues. It depends upon the priority, it depends upon the requirement of the environment. Here probably you want an energy efficient solution, so you are taking this. Here you want a load balancing solution, so you are going with this. So this is based on this type of requirements, you can decide on what type of solution would be better for you. So next I'm moving to the server consolidation problem. What is server consolidation exactly? Server consolidation is actually a technique where we can place this virtual machines in the physical machine. That's one of the benefits of virtualization, is that that by gathering several type of virtual machines, we can place them in a single physical server. So by taking that benefit of virtualization, we can think about server consolidation, which is used by different data centers to increase the resource utilization as well as to reduce the electric power consumption, or to make it a more energy efficient solution. So two things we can get from the server consolidation. One is the resource utilization, better resource utilization, and second is energy efficient solution. So let's see this particular example. Here in the left hand side, you can see that there are four physical machines running different type of virtual machines. And if you look at the utilization of resources, then this one is the 55%, this is having 70%, 40%, and 20%. So just going by this number, we can say that this is overloaded, and the whole scenario is not load balancing. That is the first point. And second, this one is the overloaded among this, and this one is the underloaded. However, another point that we can understand from here, that we can utilize the resources much better way, and we can make it a more energy efficient. How? See, there 55% is used resource utilization for this particular server, and here the requirement is 20%. So if it is possible to migrate this to this server, then you can easily switch off this particular server, and you can save some energy. Similarly, not this one. And for this particular server, which is having 40% utilization of resources, can be scheduled to here. So in this way, What we can do, we can migrate the VMs running in these two physical machines to the other physical machines where there is a place, and can switch off these physical machines for better energy saving. So that is the solution here given. This one is migrated to this one, and this one is migrated to this one, and then you can switch off this to save some energy to make it more energy efficient solution, and the resource utilization of these two is also very good. So this is the basic concept of server consolidation. So what are the different approaches for server consolidation? The very simple approach or the basic approach is the static consolidation. Static consolidation means the virtual machine stays in the same physical server during their whole lifetime. So for doing that, one thing is very clear, that the peak load demand is known. Otherwise, it is not possible to keep the virtual machine in the same physical machine. So if you know, if you have a very good idea about the peak load demand, then only you can place servers, then only you can place virtual machines in the physical servers so that they can stay there for their whole lifetime. So utilization of peak load demand is can ensure that the physical machine does not overload. However, doing this is very difficult task, because how it is possible to figure out the peak load demand, because it's a very dynamic environment in real real scenario. There may be changes in the demand, so very difficult to identify that peak point of load demand. So another point is, however, if it is possible to figure out this peak load demand, then only as the practical scenario is very dynamic in nature, and there will be high and down in the demands, there will be some situations when it can cause idleness, and the workloads can present the variable demand patterns, so this idleness will be very common scenario. So if there is an idleness, the resource utilization will not be good. So again, this static consolidation is a very simple, very naive approach, but still it's not a very good solution, because resource utilization may be hampered and very difficult to predict the peak load demand. So the another approach is the dynamic consolidation approach. In dynamic consolidation, what it can do, it dynamically changes this virtual machine capacities according to the workload demands, current workload demands. And based on that, it may need to migrate the virtual machines between one physical machine to another physical machine. And when it is doing that, it is actually solving the problem of overloading situation, because it can pull out physical machines from an overloaded state where the workload demands are high, and you probably need to migrate the virtual machine from that physical machine to some other physical machine. And that is one thing. Another point is, it can also make it energy efficient, because if it is migrated from one physical machine to another physical machine, and if it is possible to turn off some physical server, you can save energies. But on the other hand, if it is not possible to turn off a physical server, or you may need to keep a physical server on, it may take more energy. So this is how these two approaches are trying to solve the server consolidation problem. So the basic comparison between these two approaches are like, static technique is very useful in consistent demand, because demand need to be consistent. You have to predict the peak load demand very nicely. So that is one point from static technique. But in dynamic technique, it is useful for both. If the demand is static, then it is good. If the demand is dynamic, then also it is good. Second is VM, and VM to PM mapping is not changed for a long time in static technique, because as I told you, if you have this idea of peak load demand, once you place the VM in the physical machine, it will stay there for a long period of time, so or the entire lifetime. So it is not changed for a long time. However, in the dynamic technique, it is not the case. It can change several times to accommodate the demands, and changing that Mapping means the migration. In static technique, it is over-provisioning. Why it is over-provisioning? Because you are taking the peak load demand as the bound. So that is maximum value, right? So resources are over-provisioned in static technique. However, in dynamic technique, it is more balanced because you are not taking any such type of bounds and it is changes with time with the demands coming from the user. Then workload are pre-predicted. As I told you, you have to predict the load of the you have to predict the workloads that are coming from the client. So it is pre-predicted. But here it is real-time predictions. You don't need to based on some historical data, but with the window moving, you can make this real-time prediction over the workload. In the static technique, wasting of resources when physical machine is underutilized, as I told you that it is over-provisioned. So if it is over-provisioned, if the demand is not high, then the resources will be underutilized. However, in dynamic technique, it is better managed by the load balancing because the VM mapping can change, VM to PM mapping can change, and it can make the overall system a more balanced one. In static technique, we don't need any kind of migration, but in dynamic technique, migration is the key. And static is very easier to manage. It's a bit complicated to manage the whole thing in dynamic technique. However, that is actually the requirement of the environment. It's complicated, but that is important because the real scenario is dynamic in nature. So static technique is not effective for changing demands, but the changing demands is the real scenario. We cannot avoid the situation. The real environment is imposing changing demands. So dynamic technique is effective solution for handling this challenge, but it has also its own research challenges. So now we'll move to the VM migration techniques. The first step of any VM migration technique is to detect or to select the destination physical machine, because VM is running in one physical machine, say a source physical machine, and it needs to be migrated to some other physical machine, which is say destination physical machine. Now, how to select that destination physical machine? For explaining that concept, I'm giving a very simple example. Suppose in any environment, there are three physical machines running, like PM1, PM2, and PM3, and these are showing their CPU and memory resources status or utilization status. And looking at this situation, we can say that physical machine CPU is underutilized, but memory is overutilized, however, and the other two are properly balanced. Now in this situation, assume there is another physical machine, say physical machine 4, and three VMs are running over there. The VM1, where very high CPU utilization, poor memory utilization, so overutilized CPU, underutilized memory, and the rest two VMs, VM2 and VM3, are balanced. So to make it a balanced load balancing environment, a VM1 from PM4 can be migrated. For this, VM, as it is, just looking at the figure, we can say that VM1 from PM4 can be placed with physical machine 1 nicely, so it can be migrated from PM4 to PM1, and this is how you will get an idea what are the basic matrix behind selection of the PM, that is the utilization of the resources of that PM. So here the PM1 only, the resources are not properly utilized, and that is the reason behind selecting physical machine 1 for migrating VM1 from PM4. And next is the trade-off. For explaining the trade-off, I'm giving another example. Say this is one situation where three machines are running, machine M2 and M3. These are three physical machines where physical machine 1 and 2 are on state and physical machine 3 is in off state. And in physical machine 1, two VMs are running, VM1 and VM3. And in physical machine 2, VM2 is running. Now, in this situation, suppose there is a change in the requested capacity. So if we look at this particular figure, we can see that initially there is this load prediction of for VM3, and this particular line is showing that load prediction, and initial VM requested capacity was like this, up to this, marked by this line. But after some time, I mean at this point, there is an increase in the demand. So now the demand is quite high, and we have to reconfigure VM3. So the new VM3 requirement is this one, which is greater than this VM3. So this is the increased VM3 capacity. Now it is no more possible to run VM3 on machine 1. So what to do? How to solve this particular problem? So there are several solutions exist. For example, the first option could be we can move VM2 from machine M2 to machine M1. We can move VM2 from machine M2 to M1. Then we will get space in VM2 and we will place VM3 to M2. That is one option. Another option could be we can turn on M3 and move VM3 to M3. Right? And so in option 2, all the three physical machines are on now. The option 3 is turn on machine 3 and move VM3 to M3, and then move VM2 from M2 to M1 and turn off M2. So three options are there. But looking at this option, which one is better? That we have to understand. And for doing that, we can consider two things. One is the migration cost and another is the energy cost. So if you look at the solution one, you have to migrate two times, VM2 from M2 to M1 and VM3 to M2, M2 to, from move VM3 to M2. So one migration here, and this is simply placement. And now if you look at the option two, there is first you have to turn on M3. That means energy cost is there, adding energy, more energy, and then there is a placement of VM3 to M3. So energy cost will be high in this example. There is no energy included in the option one. But in option three, you have to turn on M3, so energy cost is there. Then move VM3 to M3, that is simply placement, and then VM2 from M2 to M1, that is the migration, and then turn off. So here you can see that there is a migration and there is a placement, there is an energy and there is a placement, there is an energy cost, there is a placement along with migration. So looking at all these options, you can easily figure out which one is the better solution. Of course, this one is better solution in my point of view, from the energy and migration cost, if you combine these two costs here. So in this way, you can think about a solution for solving the problem. You can think about the cost associated with the solution in terms of energy cost, in terms of transmission cost, in terms of communication or the performance cost, or the migration overhead, and so on. So there are different factors which are actually dominating the cost function. And by looking at the cost function, you can decide some objective function, and you can pick your solution accordingly. So next is how we can address this type of load balancing or server consolidation issues. As I told you, different approaches like static approach and dynamic approach, and different methods are there for addressing this approaches, like exact method, where you can use some mathematical model and some exact algorithms like stochastic programming or linear programming, dynamic programming, game theory based programming to solve that. Then there is this heuristic approach also, heuristic approach are very, very problem specific, problem dependent. Based on the problem, you can think about a particular heuristic approach for solving that, like first fit decreasing, best fit decreasing, or random fit, next fit, like that. Another solution could be a meta heuristic, which is not problems dependent. It's a kind of a guided environment in the space, in the search space, where you can figure out a good solution to solve that particular problem, and like genetic algorithms and colony optimization, like this. So one thing I can say that this VM placement or server consolidation problems are a special type of multiple knapsack problem, and we all know that multiple knapsack problem are kind of an NP complete problem. So you can formulate your problem, and if you are not getting a very good solution, real solutions, or the solutions which are good for real environment, then you can think about some heuristic approach for that. And doing that, you can consider different type of parameters like hardware threshold or network traffic, migration overhead, reliability, different type of performance metrics that I discussed previously in designing that heuristic algorithm, or in designing the optimization function for your problem. So now coming to this migration types, two migration types are popularly known. One is the cold migration. In cold migration, the services running on the server are suspended during the migration. So here, first it suspend the virtual machine which is running there. So virtual machine is first stopped and then migrated. Whereas, that is the solution, after migration at the destination node, virtual machines need to be started. And in this procedure, it is stopped in the first machine or the source machine, then it started at the destination machine, and then it is migrating from one source to the destination. The whole procedure takes some time, and services are actually, the performance of the services are actually hampered by that, and downtime will be there in this type of migration. High downtime will be there. Whereas in the live migration, it's a very simple and interesting approach. First, it identifies the static part of the VM, and first is transfer the static part of the VM and keep the VM running on the source server or source physical machine. Once the static part is transferred from the source machine to the destination physical machine, it suspended the VM in the source machine and start transferring the remaining part of the VMs. And so this is the period of time when it is actually down. And after this migration at the destination end, when all the remaining part is transferred, it can start the VM at the destination node. So the live VM migration actually reduces the downtime, but it engages more resources for a longer period of time. But the live migration is actually a very popular solution for migration in cloud computing platforms. And I will discuss the live VM migration in Google Compute Engine. So just looking at this figure, when there is a migration required, it is triggered by the cluster management component, and it schedules a target task. So the target task means, if you look at this figure, you can see that this is the source task or the source physical machine, and then this one is the destination physical machine. So at the source machine, the source VM is actually running, and cluster manager can send a request to the destination machine to set up a target virtual machine. So that is actually the preparation time. And once the target VM is created, it starts migration process. So the source VM, which is running in the source node, it is still running. But after the migration is initiated here, and after the authentication process, the source runs while migrating state. So source is running here, but the states are migrated from source physical machine to the destination physical machine. So here it is coordinating with the destination machine is coordinating with the source machine. And during this period, it is you can think it as a brownout duration, because we all know this brownout duration means if there is a sudden drop in the voltage, then the light dims, right? So it is that kind of situation when the performance of the application may be hampered, or maybe there is some downtime. But after that, there is a point when the source is completely stopped and paused, and it is resumed at the destination node. And before that, there is a blackout duration. So services are not at all available anywhere, not at the source physical machine, not at the destination physical machines. And after this migration step, when the VM is ready to run at the destination node, it can start running here, and the source machine will completely stop that VM machine. So you can think about this period as a downtime period here. And this is how live migration is implemented in Google Compute Engine. So different types of live virtual machine migration techniques are there: pre-copy, post-copy, and hybrid technique. Let me explain the pre-copy technique first. It's an iterative push phase followed by a stop and copy phase. Iterative push phase means iteratively it is pushing pages from the source machine to the destination machine, and then it stop and then copy the rest part of the VM machine from the source to the destination. So the first step is it initiate the migration, then destination server is being selected, resources are reserved at the destination side. Then it captured the whole virtual memory and assume it is dirty. This concept of dirty pages is same as the concept of dirty pages in the operating system, where the pages in the main memory that have been modified during any writing operation on to the disk are marked as dirty, because they need to be flushed and to the disk before they can be freed. So here also there is this concept of dirty pages in migration, because it is the pages migrated from the source physical machine to the destination machine. So when the virtual server is running, its memory pages are transferred to the destination host, and during this phase the virtual server might continue to modify the memory pages, and that can create those dirty pages. So these pages are actually the dirty pages which need to be retransmitted to the destination nodes. So it will check whether there is a stop and copy. So if there is some if it is no, then it will keep retransmitting those dirty pages from the source node to the destination node, and then finally it will suspend the VM at the and transfer the VM state. VM state means the CPU state, registers, VM memory, etc., to the destination server. So that is the final transmission of the rest part of the VM. And then it is able to resume the VM at the destination server and commit. So this is how pre-copy works. So just look at this particular figure. So the first step is the pre-migrate phase, this one, this is marked by the yellow one. And in this pre-migrate phase, it is live on the host machine A physical. There are two host machines. This is the source host machine, host A, and this one is the destination host machine. So at this period of time, it is live on this host machine A. So VM is running here. So next phase is the reservation phase. In the reservation phase, a VM or the resources for that VM are reserved at the host B. Still at this phase also, the VM is running at the host A. Next is this iterative pre-copy rounds. So iteratively the states are actually transmitted from host A to host B, and this is the time that you can be treated it as a brown out time, and here the performance degraded on A. And next comes this stop and copy. So now the VM is not running in host A, as well as it is not running at host B. It is completely downtime, and it is simply transmitting the rest part of the VM to the destination host. And after that step, the VM will be deleted from the host A, and the VM at host B will be up and start running. So after this period of time, it is live on B. So this is how pre-copy actually works in for migration. Next is the post-copy technique. In the post-copy technique, it minimizes the network page faults by pushing the future requested pages from the source physical machine to the destination machine before there is any fault by running the VM in destination machine. So the steps are very similar. First migration, it initiates the migration, then select a destination server, then reserve the resources at the destination site and capture the VM minimum state. So the first three steps are same like the pre-copy. Then it captured the VM minimum state and transfer that VM state to the destination server. Transfer VM minimum state to the destination server. And after this step, now the VM at the destination server is ready to run. So it can resume the VM at the destination server. After doing that, VM may need some pages, right? It may face some page fault. So if there is a page fault, it will copy the faulty pages from the source server. If there is no fault, all memory pages of VM is transferred or not, it will check that. If it is transferred, then migration stop. Otherwise, it will just keep retransmitting pages from the source server. So let's see this example of pre-migration technique. The first step is the pre-migration technique. At that period of time, it is live on A and the virtual machine is running on host A. Then the next step is the reservation, which is same like the pre-copy case where it reserved the resources for guest VM. And then there is the stop and copy. So now the VM is not running, not in the source physical machine, not in the destination physical machine. And now it is pushing the pages from the host A to the host B. And at this period of time, the performance degraded on B. So the total migration time you can see is like this here. Which is less in respect to the pre-copy system. Here is this is actually the total migration time. And once it commit, it will be live on B and deleted from the host A. So this is how pre-copy and the post-copy concepts are actually using for migration. So looking at this diagram, we can see the total migration time taken by the pre-copy concept is like starting from preparation to the restart of that. That is the total migration time, but the performance degradation due to the dirty page is for when there is this iterative push method for the pre-copy techniques, and dirty downtime is due to the remaining data pages. So this is how the things in pre-copy, whereas in post-copy, the downtime is just after it is stopped at the host node, and then it is restart immediately after it has all those minimum pages required for restarting the or resuming the virtual machine. So downtime is much less here, but the performance degradation may happen due to the network fault. And total migration time is pretty much same here, where VM memory can be switching from the source host to the destination host. So some comparison of pre-copy and post-copy, like there are different metrics like preparation time, downtime, resume time, pages transferred between the servers, host server and the destination server, and the total migration time. Definitely in pre-copy technique it is more, whereas in post-copy technique it is very less. And performance degradation is quite high in the pre-copy technique because of the dirty pages, and whereas performance degradation is not that high in the post-copy technique due to the dirty pages, but there is a chance of faulty pages, and it could be high for servicing of the faulty pages. So hybrid technique is a combination of this pre-copy and post-copy techniques, and it will combine this to both the concepts and to get a better solution from that. Let me explain some factors which are very important in impacting the performance metrics. Like the first one is the downtime. So downtime can be defined as TD here, which is depends on the page dirty rate, which is denoted by D, and the page size L, and the duration of the last pre-copy round, say TN. This is divided by the bandwidth. So this is how we can define the downtime and amount of transferred data. That can be defined by the amount of VM memory, virtual machine memory, at TI mine, for all the previous instances, or for the all the previous time instances, where for TI minus one, that is time taken to migrate dirty memory pages during just previous round. So either it is VMEM, and that is the amount of virtual memory at the initial state I equals to zero. Otherwise, it is the dirty page rate into the time taken to migrate to the previous round dirty memory pages. Then the total migration time, it could be defined as a total amount of memory divided by the bandwidth. So this is how we can define different performance metrics. And the other performance metrics related with this concept is the preparation time, that is the time difference between the initiation of the migration technique and transferring that VM from one source to another sources. Resume time is another one. I have discussed these things in during the explanation of that procedure of pre-copy and the post-copy. Then there is application degradation, because due to the migration, the performance of the application is interrupted and slow down the services. So that downtime may be increased, that can cause a serious application degradation. Similarly, migration overhead is also there, because it needs some extra machine resources to perform the migration. Performance overhead, because migration is solving some issues related with the load balancing, fault tolerance, or the server consolidation, but along with that, it can introduce delay, network overheads during application execution. So performance overhead is also there. Link speed, the whole this servers, I mean the host server and the destination server, they are two remote devices. So faster transfer requires more bandwidth among them. So link speed is another very essential performance metric here. Then there is this page dirty rate. If the dirty rate is higher, then it increases data sent per iteration. So if you need to increase more pages, more data, that depends upon the link speed, and that also control the performance overhead of the overall thing. So it leads in increasing total migration time and the service downtime. So this performance metrics can affect each other, and very interesting to study their behavior during the different migration in different scenarios. So due to the time constant, I'm leaving this part. Or how much time I left?
Madam, you have another 10 minutes.
Only 10 minutes? Okay. Okay, let me skip these things. I'm going to the... okay, just giving a little bit of the idea. So if anyone is interested, he can explore, he or she can explore the Q emulator, that is a quick emulator for studying the VM live migration, which is simply based on the socket programming. So you can see that source can connect socket, and two things are running. One is the server side program, another one is the destination program. So from server side, it can connect the destination through the socket, then it can send a config request to the destination. Based on the config request, it can create a VM. So that is the preparation of the VM migration here, and it can also enable the log dirty pages, send the whole memory snapshots to the destination. Destination can receive those things, and this step is actually an iterative step, because it is sending different dirty memory pages to the destination, and destination will receive and restore them. And then there is this suspend step. So after this suspend step, the VM is not running in the host machine or not in the destination machine. But it keeps sending those dirty memory pages, and after receiving those pages, it can start the VM in the destination site. and it can unpause the VM and it can start the emulator. So with the help of this quick emulator and virtualizer, you can experience the VM like migration by emulating it in this environment. And finally, after doing the migration, it can close the socket and destroy the VM at the source end. So looking at the generic model of any live VM migration, there are two, three things very important. One is the measurement of the dirty rate that it can collect from the different physical machines as well as from the historical data of those of the migration traces. And once it analyzes all this dirty rate measurement data and it can figure out the dirty rate, it can send it to the page transmission rate controller, which can help a prediction model to decide upon the threshold values. And this again will help to take the migration decision whether it's good to migrate or not based on the performance prediction model and page transmission rate controller. It can take that migration decision and then it will migrate the whole thing and will keep the data associated with that migration procedure as trace in the historical data, which can again used for the future purpose of migration. So this is how the generic model of live VM migration works. Now coming to the research challenges, the expectations are like migration must be seamless. I mean, the migration may take place, but customers or consumers don't need to suffer from any downtime. That is the expectation. But it's very hard to fulfill this expectation because live migration moves the VM without disconnecting with the client. However, there is the downtime. So most of the service providers are claiming that it is 99.99% availability. But if the migration is there, it's very hard to fulfill that demand of 99.99%. But still, with the help of this efficient mechanism, it's possible to achieve that type of performance. And performance of this live VM migration must be very high for providing the continuous services. As I told you, they claim almost 99.99% availability. But if migration is there, then it may hamper the downtime and that it may hamper that performance also. So current techniques for solving this issue can face a number of challenges for different type of application like data intensive applications. They may suffer with the network faults, they may suffer consumption of bandwidth and cloud resources, overloaded virtual machines. And this common challenges that that hamper live migration are like that we have discussed about the different performance metrics related with the with this migration techniques or transfer rate problem, a page resend problem like dirty pages or the faulty pages, then missing page problem, then migration of VM over WAN. Because migration of VM over LAN is one case. If it is over wide area network, then the network cost or net communication cost or consumption of bandwidth would be very high. So that is another challenge associated with that. So these are some of the research challenges that associated with this migration techniques and very interesting to explore. Along with that, there are several research problems you can design or you can look into to explore, like resource allocation, VM scheduling, fault tolerance techniques, load balancing techniques, cost optimization techniques. In cost, you can consider migration cost, as I discussed, and network and communication cost, downtime cost. You can think about the energy efficiency solution like the energy and power consumption. Green computing is very popular research area nowadays. And finally, the trade-off. So I don't have much time, but I'd like to give you a very simple idea of how you can think about some research problem in this area. So if you think about this VM placement or the migration problem or the load balancing, resource allocation, whatever the problem, it's finally you can reduce it as a function, mapping function of VMs. Where the VM is a set of virtual machines running in the data centers to the physical machines available in that data centers, right? So you have to think about some function, some mapping function, VM and VM to PM, that can handle this this load balancing, that can handle cost optimization, migration, network communication cost, etc. So when you're thinking about this type of mapping function, you can also think about some optimization function, like minimizing the migration cost. Okay, let me write it here. Minimizing the migration cost. Minimizing the network and communication cost. Minimizing the downtime cost. Right. So if it is possible to design a mapping function from VM to PM, which can provide you an optimized solution by minimizing the migration cost, by minimizing the network and communication cost, by minimizing the downtime cost, by improving the maximizing the energy efficiency, then you can say that you have a multi-objective functions, and by solving that multi-objectives function, you can find a mapping between VM to PM that can solve these issues. So this is how you can formulate a research problem in taking this issues or these challenges under consideration, and can think about some heuristic approach. Because as I told you, this is kind of an NP-complete problem. So some heuristic approach you can think about for solving this optimization functions, and can figure out some good solution from this problems. So next, and as I told you, it's kind of a trade-off between the cost and performance. So you may want to minimize the cost and want to maximize the performance. So this sort of trade-off can also be think about as a problem solution. So these are some of the references. I have taken some figures and diagrams from this papers, and this could be a very good start for exploring this particular research area. And there are some references for our work by my student and my colleagues. And if you are interested, you can also go through these papers to explore more on cloud and migration techniques. And that's all from my side. Thank you. Now I'm going back to the site. And so if there is any questions, we'd be happy to address those questions.
Thank you, madam, for such an interesting and informative talk. We have collected some questions from the YouTube chat site, so you can look into those, or I can ask the questions to you, whichever you are comfortable with.
YouTube channel is not open here, so if you just simply ask the question,
okay, then sure. First question is, what are the available resources to support cloud migration?
What are the available resources? Yeah, there are some
cloud migration.
Yeah, there are some emulators available. As I mentioned, one emulator like Quick Emu or QEMU, that is an emulator and virtualization. And using that QEMU, you can experience the VM migration kind of approaches there.
Madam, the next question is, how to measure the cost of migration?
See, there are several performance metrics associated with the migration, like migration overhead. There is this downtime, there is this preparation time, there is response time. I mentioned some of these performance metrics there, and these metrics are actually the members of a cost function. If you want to design a cost function for migration, then you have to consider all these things, and your objective will be to minimizing that cost function, right? So if you take these factors, you can design a cost function for the migration.
Okay, ma'am. The next question is, what is the future of cloud computing with machine learning? So can machine learning be involved in this?
Yeah, see, cloud computing is a distributed environment. It's an computing infrastructure environment. It's providing those the requirement. It's actually an environment to fulfill the requirement of computation, storage services, etc. And machine learning is an algorithmic approach, or it's a solution that you are using to solve some problems. right? When you are solving a problem using machine learning, you may need this resources of computation, you may need this resources of storage, etc. And that resources are provided by the cloud computing environment. So, I mean, there is no fight between cloud computing and machine learning. It's like cloud computing environment is providing the required resources to your applications or what type of machine learning algorithms you want to input for that.
And the next question is, are data sets and simulators available to work on these research challenges?
For this migration technique?
Migration, the research challenges that you talked about.
Okay, no such data set is available, but as I told you, there are some emulators are available like QEMU and all that. So you can emulate the environment or you can simulate the environment and create some simulated data set on that. However, I don't know whether there is, I mean, I can't say that there is no data set because it's not in my knowledge. But you can explore that area.
These are a set of questions that were there. Thank you, madam, for you.
To all the organizers and the faculty members behind this webinar. And I would also like to thank the participants for their interest and their time. Thank you so much. Thank you to everyone.
Thank you. Now we will begin our next talk, Cloud Computing and its Application by Professor Shomokanti Ghosh. Professor Shomokanti Ghosh is a professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur. He received his PhD from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, IIT Kharagpur. Before joining IIT Kharagpur, he worked as a scientist in the Indian Space Research Organization in the area of satellite remote sensing and geographic information systems. He has been awarded National Geospatial Chair Professorship by the Department of Science and Technology, DST, Government of India. He has more than 300 research papers in reputed journals and conference proceedings. His research interests include spatial data science, machine learning, cloud computing, fog computing, and IoT. Dr. Ghosh is a senior member of IEEE and a member of ACM. I would like to invite Professor Shomokanti Ghosh to begin his talk. Sir, please.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for a nice introduction. Thanks a lot. Hope you can hear me.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yeah, that's great. Okay, so today, first of all, thanks to Jadavpur University, this IT department, especially I have a long connection with Jadavpur University, in the sense I have not studied there, but I usually regularly visit both and your, especially the main campus, also IT department, that is one part. Secondly, we had a very good bunch of students who are doing PhD, etc. from JU. Especially I have one scholar now who is DDSM tech in JU only, in your IT department in JU only. Nevertheless, so today's talk will be having something on cloud, cloud plus type of things. And then actually, as mentioned by Dr. Chatterjee, that we do something on spatial data science. So we'll try to also give some view that how these two merge together, or how these are complement, or how cloud computing supports this sort of activities, right? So let me share the PPT. hope you can view the PPT, right? It is visible?
Yes, sir. The slide is visible.
Ah, great. That's the slide is visible. That is fine. So I, I should say, directed by Dr. Gurpita Ray, I keep the name as Cloud Computing Future Generation Computing and Applications. And just to make it two part, one is looking at more of that cloud, what people used to say these days as cloud ecosystem, right? So it is not only cloud, but a lot more than that, which is actually in practice, right? So cloud, fog, edge, IoT, and rather anything you can add, human intelligence, as I was just at the fag end of the previous speaker. So that I believe that was on something on VM migration and something on machine learning. So all those things are coming to play together. And another thing, as we worked on spatial data science, where the spatial cloud has a good amount of role. So we thought that sharing something on spatial cloud will be good. It's a large field, and also there are a lot of opportunities out there, right? So before I start, let me put a quote-unquote disclaimer. Like the most of the several things are a lot of contributions of my students, and several text and images or pictures are taken. I tried to refer everywhere, but if it is somewhere I missed, please excuse me. So several figures are taken from different places. So especially for academic purpose, we are sharing. So you can definitely use that. And if you want, I can share these slides later on to Dr. Rai, so who in turn can share to you. Okay. So, so first couple of slides are something which you might have seen several times. I usually, if I am giving a talk, usually these slides are there. And not only that, these are very common, and I believe most of you are well accustomed with the well versed with the things. Nevertheless, it is interesting to see that it all this business what we are jumping today started in 1960s, right? When there was a John McCarthy opined that computing someday will be organized as a public utility, right? Like we do electricity, I do water supply. So it will become a public utility. So computing, so it is 1960s when even mainframe were something very difficult to realize, but that time it is there. Not only that, there was not even internet, where the basic overall domain of cloud computing is surviving on. But it says that something is there. Rather, in 1966 also there is a book. This book you will search in the internet, some form or other it will be available. The Challenges of Computer Utility explained all modern day. So I read not all fully, but some part of the things. Rather, it is you will find that all whatever we are thinking of, something somewhere, how many, some 50, 55 years ago, somebody thought that this will be, these are the challenges. And everything gone for a kickstart with, definitely we understand, with the ARPANET project, which gone for connecting the computing, later on people, services, etc. Together. So this was a, so what we see that it is at least around starting around 60, 70 years ago, all those things people tried to look at, right? So when we talk about utility computing, we have this very popular picture, like as you open the tap, water flows. So you open the tap and different services flows, right, to the things. What is important here is the meter. So whatever we get is a metered service. We pay as we go, or pay per use of the things. That is one of the things which we look at. And this all encompassing definition of National Institute of Standard and Technology, which talks about this cloud computing as a ubiquitous, convenient, on-demand network access to a shared pool of configurable computing resources, anything, starting from hardware resources to services, that means our application as a soft resources, that can be rapidly provisioned and released without with minimal management effort. That means you don't have to send a mail and get the things, etc. So you should go on a fly, as we do for our different services, like especially like our electricity. We use and the meter records it. Nobody restricts per se to say that you need to use this much only. As long as I am paying, I can go. There may be a per amount, all those things are fine, but things are there. Even for our telecom services, which is a great example of totally, what we say, service-driven operation, like you pay for the thing and you get data service and calling service, anything on the things, and rather you don't bother that what is going on at that thing. So what we look at, that somewhere or other you can connect to this telecom and then it just works, right? Rather, what we see, a total convergence of the whole thing with the 5G in place, rather people are talking about 6G, the overall paradigm of connectivity and computing are going to be changed, right? So that is a huge thing. So what we bothered about is that only how much I need to pay for what type of services. That is our only bother. So in what we look at as anything as a service, whatever we look at as a service, rather, as I several times mentioned, that NASA started a program, I don't know still whether it is there or not, that is a science as a service, right? So they provide all infrastructure, their data, etc. Then you can work on it, have some intelligent algorithms working on the things, and then you work on it. The only restriction is there, you basically sign off that you have a 50-50 rights. So they do have also on the right on your intellectual right on the things. So this tells everything, like you have on-demand services, resource pooling, broad network access, rapid elasticity, measured services, right? So this property, set of properties, makes it as, call it as a quote-unquote cloud or as a thing, right? And we have three popular type of services. One is the infrastructure as such. On the other hand, we have a software as a service, as we all use like Google Docs and other things. And in between, you have a platform where we have a development platform. But anything we can have as a service, like data as a service, we are using Dropbox and other things, OneDrive and so on and so forth. And several services we can use. So these are the same things. There are a few more characteristics, as we all know, that it is a massive scale. It's massive scalability is one of the, or what we say, elasticity is one of the major goals. And in doing so, there are a lot of things at the background goes on, right? So I can scale up the operation, I can scale down the operation. That means if we look at the infrastructure as a service, so if I have a particular configuration, I can scale up to a higher configuration and so forth. And it needs to be done seamlessly. That means there should not be any interruption, or you cannot tell the user that now you close down all your apps and then once you go to this higher configuration, then you go on reloading the things. So that may indeed require a VM migration. It may require sort of resource pooling in the whole scenario. Even there may be required that you from the in some cases that you are moving from one data center to other data center type of thing. So it becomes a different ballgame altogether. So you can scale up. When I don't require the resources, I scale down. Then resilient computing, creating a homogeneity across the things. Right? When I work on a particular things, then I require a homogeneous environment to work on. I don't care that how you maintain at your end. Like when you give me a thing, I need a homogeneous environment. Then it should be geographical distribution. Two major thing what we look at is a virtualization, like which was there for a long time. It is not like that suddenly with the cloud the virtualization came into play. We are used to virtualization stuff from quite a long time, but it uses at every scale, like starting from your resource virtualization to application virtualization to even to the extent of network virtualization, right? We are used to virtual networks, etc., but it goes for a different scale. So I can have network virtualization, that means I can have a physical network, I can emulate different other networks, virtual networks over a physical network, right? And another things which push the whole thing, what we see that last one decade, rather more than one decade or so, whole world has migrated from a data-driven architecture to a service-driven architecture, right? Now we hardly look for data rather than look for services, whether it is computing, whether buying something from the, say, Flipkart, Amazon, etc., whether your telecom services. So everywhere it's a, what you are looking for, it is a, or you're booking your ticket through IRCTC or Make My Trip and Clear Trip, Yatra.com. Everywhere we are looking for the services, not the data. I have some requirement, and if I can place this requirement in appropriate things, it goes seamlessly across the thing and gives me a valid result. And if there is any service failure, there should be a rollback of the whole thing. So this, I believe that all of you are quite accustomed with this service-oriented architecture. So it's a some sort of, we can say, some loosely bound stuff between the provider and consumer. So the provider provides service, consumer consume the service. The provider can be a consumer can be a provider. But the another important part of all the thing is that we have a service registry, or where these services are there. So in other sense, I have a registry where the provider provides that these are the services I am offering, and then the consumer basically look at the registry and connect to the provider and talk to each other, right? So this sort of service oriented architecture, to be very true, this is something which is not very new either, right? So I think most of the this young generation might not have seen our good old, you know, directory services, which allows us to have things. So that sort of things in having at the application level brings a different ball game, right? And of course we have low cost software, like if you are using Microsoft or Google Spreadsheet or Google Docs or something you are using latest version of maybe Microsoft Office without any paying anything for that things, or paying a marginal amount for the things, right? And in some cases what we see, that can be a availability of advanced security, though people who are working on cloud security. So we also little bit work on cloud security. We have people have different opinion. Nevertheless, it gives you a better way of some feeling of security. Think about your Dropbox, right? This Dropbox might be, the administrator of the Dropbox can read your document, that may be an insecurity, but nevertheless, if you look at it, is primarily a fail-safe mode, right? You that does not crash, like you, once you put a Dropbox, the availability is everywhere. Never on the other at the same time, you have a high reliability on the data. So, and not only that, but as you know, that we have a concept of a virtual machine monitor or hypervisor, where you can security patches can help you in having some level of security. So as we discussed, we have software as a service, infrastructure as a service, and in between platform as a service. Rather, we can have anything as a service which can be there. Now, as it is based on service oriented architecture, which in turn is based on a some sort of a XML based technology, which primarily is a unlike HTML, is a data transformation language type of thing. So it allows you to define your schema, your way of looking at it. So I can have something, a movement of this XML document at the back end itself, with appropriate interfaces can have realized different type of services, right? So SaaS one thing what we use, that Google Spreadsheet, Google Docs, whereas infrastructure, when those who are, if you are using that Amazon AWS EC2 type of services where you provision virtual machines and work on it. I will just show you, or rather tell, will show you that we at IIT Kharagpur also we build a private cloud. We named it as a Meghomala. A private cloud in the sense that it can be used within the IIT Kharagpur network, and so that it's a IaaS infrastructure. We give virtual machines for a time period to different users, primarily faculty and research scholars, to work on some of the things. And it's a really helpful for several people who want to do something, especially for scholars, etc., who want to do something, some simulation or some experimentation which requires a high bandwidth high computational need for a less amount of time. It is not like that there is for a larger time. I want to run some simulation for 2 days, 4 days, and for that I require a maybe 64 GB system or 128 GB systems. And getting that will be doing either go for Amazon. So we are trying to have this set of services that within the institute network, and it's really a great help for things. And this sort of mechanisms are in several places, I believe. So we have this stack. So as we understand that in case of our something analogy with our typical TCP/IP or OSI type of network stack, like higher layer things at all the lower layer properties, or leverages on the lower layer properties, like SaaS ideally should have some infrastructure to run the things. So, and the user, or which can be human user or maybe a other system user, which are mostly the cloud clients, right, which connect to some interface, usually HTTP may be the popular interface to connect, but there can be definitely different app. It can be mobile app or different type of app can work on the thing. So that is, these are some of the things. This is also we typically know. One is that private, community, private, public is the two broad things. Like our Meghomala is a private cloud. You cannot use from IIT Kharagpur outside IIT Kharagpur network. Public cloud is AWS, Azure, Google Cloud, and there are several public clouds which sells cloud services for different type of at different level. Something IaaS, something PaaS, something IaaS type of things, right? In between, we have a hybrid cloud which primarily look for a primarily a mix of private and public. So if required, it can have private, public, and even community. So community cloud is some sort of a, some people say it is a semi-public type of things. That means a number of category of user, but having a simple, a specific community to serve. Like say IITs may have a IIT cloud where all IITs can think. Even MHRD camp, or now it is Ministry of Education, can have a MOE cloud where all MHRD affiliated or MHRD whatever institution under MHRD can be there, right? So these are very pretty useful, especially for scientific community. Like if I have a nanoscience cloud, so it can have tools, techniques, etc., which are used for nanoscience related applications and type of things, right? So these are community cloud which becomes popular at different aspects. Like not exactly they say community cloud, but there are services at the financial sector, right? Banking services, which through their core banking, every bank can interact with each other with appropriate access control mechanisms and have realized that banking services, right? Now, this is again, I believe, a lot of discussion, or you have read and discussions are there. So there is an underlining hardware, and there is a virtual machine or VMM or hypervisor, and then we can have different VMs, and these VMs can basically launch different guest OS, and then it goes on the things, right? Like if you look at that IIT Kharagpur Megamala, so now it has expanded, but we are having a Tailblade server, which is with a 16 blade server, which is basically the hardware, and then we have a OpenStack layer, which are used by this virtual machine as a hypervisor with say KVM or KN hypervisor, and then we have different virtual machines where different OS can be there. We are having all flavors of Linux. Windows we are not having, because there are some licensing issues. So Institute asks us that wherever licensing issues there, you don't venture out unless there is a valid permission. So we are having different variety of OS, and whenever a new user comes or new user requests, we ask that this is from this bunch of OS, which OS you want to be installed in your VM, right? So that OS is installed, and they go on applying, they are running their applications and developing. The beauty of the thing is that if you see a machine, like in our, say, if I consider that our Megamala, it is now expanded, but before that, so we can basically have a provision of around, I think, 64 or around 70 virtual machines. That means with that infrastructure, with some virtual machines, a configuration of 4GB or 8GB, we can have 60 odd machines, virtual machines. That means virtual instances we can provide. But those instances are not always used. Like I might have given to 70%, but at a time, only 20%, 20 or 30 people are using those infrastructure. So those, there are a lot of idle time, right? So there is a concept of most of the cloud infrastructure, there is a concept of oversubscription. Like in case of our, it allows you to go up to subscribe up to having 100 users, thinking that there will be less thing. Now, other beauty is that it is all handled by this underlining hypervisor. Another thing you see, as you go on putting one layer after another, so there should be a translation of your original code to that actual machine which is running. Like I may have a VMM which is primarily something which is based on which is a particular brand of the things. Then I have different virtual machine, or I can have a host OS out here, which is maybe a CentOS or Red Hat. We are having Red Hat. So over that, you load a Windows machine. Now you see the overall this instruction set should be appropriately handled so that it is at the underlying hardware understands that, right? Now if you look at that Google or Azure or Amazon, the scale is a different scale. So it is a very tricky business. And as we are talking about security, what we say that if we can maintain appropriate security at this level, hypervisor level, then this VM level also, then I could have made a secured scenario where external attacks could have been avoided. But there are different pitfalls also that you may argue that if the VMM itself is compromised, then the whole thing has been compromised. Not only that, and secondly, we may not be having a time or today to discuss on the security, but there are other things, like these two VMs may be on the same physical machines, right? So there is a possibility to have a side channel attack, right? I can have some sort of a attack as this machine A and B are on the same physical machine. But definitely you can argue that how do you guarantee that this attacker and the victim will be in the same machine? That also, there is a one nice paper where they show that even with Amazon EC2, they did a lot of experimentation, and with different assumption and heuristics, what they have shown that in 40% of the 40 up to not always, but up to 40% of the scenario, they can place a their so-called victim or so-called attack VM on some targeted on some victim to a hardware where the victim VM is there. In other sense, or two things may be in the same thing. So there are other hiccups definitely, but nevertheless, if you look at the whole paradigm, it's a nice way of looking whole thing, right? So, but definitely there are different ifs and buts. So if we look at the virtual machines, again, all these things are not very new. So we have process virtualization or process virtualization hardware, and there is an operating system over that. Several virtual machines are there, and above that we have different guest OS, right? So this operating system may be a Red Hat. I can have a Windows over it, right? So I can have a different thing. The thing is that there is a huge flexibility. I can have this hardware even even take your lab, like we tried here, but finally authority did not allow. Experimentation wise fine, but authority did not allow. Like look at our computing labs, right? We have a huge computer center where there are four labs of every one, four or five labs, I think. Every lab has a around 100 plus systems, right? PCs, right? Fairly good PCs, I think. 4 or 8 GB machines, which are used primarily for a centralized lab for all departments, like computer science for first year, programming, data structure, Sybil may be doing some AutoCAD type of things, chemicals, some simulator, etc. Then there is a slot difference. Usually the lab runs from 8 o'clock in the morning to around 6 o'clock in the evening. In between there may be a lunch break, otherwise the lab is always busy unless somebody is booking at the evening for some other things, right? So in other sense, you see, if you even if we say 8 to 8, another 8 to 8 or another 12 hours, the whole resource is around 500 odd machine with fairly high, another I should say high configuration, and even with 4 GB I could have 500 into 4, this much of RAM at disposal, which are in a very high connectivity things, right? Like in our within our campus, everywhere we have at least 10 gig type of backbone connectivity, and all are 100 Mbps connectivity, which is fairly good. So there could have been a chance that we can make a make this hardware with all those, even in with a single lab, and then make different VMs, and people can run the simulation and other work at night, and again we release those things at the morning. But authority or the institute has their own reservation, because in the morning 8 o'clock they are telling if your these systems are not properly rolled back to the original form, then the actual lab session will be in a trouble, and etc. Finally, they didn't allow, but we did a small experimentation with a small amount of system, and it works pretty fine. Only problem here, I have multiple hops. One way is out here, then another way is out there, going to the hardware. So next level of things, what we did as a virtual things, oh sorry, I made a blunder. So this is the things what we are talking on the guest ways on the things, where the virtual thing. Here what we are thinking, that what we are traditionally used to, we have a operating system, and we can have different virtual machine which is emulated by this operating system. But as far as the cloud is concerned, we are more out here. So we have a hardware, I have a operating system which is Red Hat or so. We have a virtual monitor which is can be VMware, Zen and type of things. We use Zen, VMware both. Then we have guestware running on the things. Then we have another concept called native virtual machine, which a virtual machine which goes takes care instead of this operating system, it have this hardware into the things, and then you can have the guestways. Right, so VM where with some I think EXP or some model which extension it gives this sort of support. Rather, all our computer system related stuff, like going for say mail services, different proxy services, SSH services all runs on this sort of configuration, whereas our Megomala runs on this sort of configuration, right? So this is another slide which is pretty common, that there can be different type of access mechanism. If you have a SaaS, web browser is the very popular access mechanism. The may not be very efficient. The advantage of the web browser is that most of the router and firewalls across the world, if they allow something, they allow this HTTP, right? So that is a one great advantage. You can if you piggyback on the things. So as we all understand, whenever whatever the cloud services, SaaS, PaaS, IaaS we are talking about, it is considering that some network is in place. That means on other things the network stack is in place. So over that it is basically running, right? So those are in place. Then whether I will use a web browser or some other customized app, that all depends that what your network underlining network stacks supports you, right? Then we have so at different scale we have different type of connectivity to work on. And this is a typical picture. Again, you will see that if it is a SaaS service, then the whole thing is managed by the provider. Like in case of Google Docs, Google Spreadsheet, the whole stack is maintained by the Google Docs, Google. And then what you venture out here is the application. Like you open Google Docs or Google Spreadsheets and other things. Whether it is a platform as a service, then this application and data is managed by the user. Rest are managed by the provider. And if we are having infrastructure as a service, then we are having this underlining up to virtualization is our business. So user has the flexibility to load its own OS, then rest of the things at the user things. So when we go more towards the IaaS, our responsibility increases, flexibility also increases. But there are trade-off between the things, right? Like you know, you have to manage the whole. So in the sense that you need to have all, suppose you want to run a database in a cloud which can be used for several purposes, like some sort of managing your ERP or something like that. Now this optimization of the things, licensing of the stuff, availability of the things, all have to be managed by the user or the client, right? Whereas in these things you are purchasing that based on your application, right? And then it may not be always cloud, may not be always economical also, that we understand. It may be a sometime a more costly affair than having is something on place. So all it depends on what sort of things you are using. That's why there is a separate area or separate vertical, what we say, cloudonomics, cloud plus economy, right? So when we should go for cloud at and when we should not go for cloud and type of things, looking at the economic point of view. Anyway, we are not going to those things. So this is a typical picture of from the, if you look at the NIST draft documentation. So what if we look at IaaS cloud, so there is a cloud manager which is more of a broker, which look like if you are hitting a Amazon AWS, you are Amazon cloud manager is primarily you are hitting. From there you it places your into the different cluster, right? So or it which is spread over different regions, right? So sometimes it may be Asia specific region one, or somewhere Europe region or North American region, based on your thing. So it will optimize based on your connectivity and also looking at your one is looking at the connectivity and also looking at that what sort of services are required and type of things, right? For a normal user, it makes a appropriate heuristic to take a call. So there is a data object storage, and also it maintain a registry out here, which by which it knows that what is which is the loading, etc., and try to do a load balance. But if it is a corporate user, say like a State Bank of India or a or even say something like what we say Dropbox. As we all know that Dropbox was I think mid of 2019 they were using primarily Amazon storage service for their storage. So they, though Dropbox is giving a data service, but Dropbox in turn falling back on the Amazon storage service. Now when Dropbox implementing over Amazon, so they have a different type of agreement or MOU or SLA type of things, right? So they want to keep what storage, etc., where it should be and type of things, right? So below that we have different cluster manager, which are geographically, which may be geographically spread and things like that. And then we have the at the down the level as a computer manager with a hypervisor and different VM, what we are seeing some previous slides. This way things work. And not only that, as we know that this typically cloud data service or the cloud data storage typically follows a what we say three-way redundancy, right? That means your same data at least replaced in a at least copied in a three places, and ideally at least two out of these should be separate seismic zone, separate power zone and separate network zone. That means in other sense they want to guarantee even there is a something catastrophe on the power or network connectivity or act of God, the data will be safe and serviceable, right? Because once you put the things in the data or services on the cloud, you expect that if I am able to connect to the net, the data should be available, right? So this is this way it the generic structure. If you look at, I am not having that slide, but you will, if you in the net things are there, if you look at the basic architecture of Google or basic architecture of Amazon or Azure, you will see that they are following somewhere or other this sort of structure only. Now as I was talking that we are having a thing called Megamala, that basic screen you can always see, but you will not able to apply, etc., because that is a only in our private network it is allowed. That is if you see Megamala at Kharagpur, so it gives a scenario. So there you have a user can apply for a VM and it is automatically given and connectivity, etc., given, and also for how many days and etc. Things are there. We do meter it, but we do not charge because it's from the institute fund and we do not charge, but we do meter the things. So it's a what we say private cloud, and it's a pretty helpful it is found to be institute found it. They initially gave a state means test type of cloud thing with lot of ifs and buts, but later on it was so useful it has been expanded now I think around four times or five times, right? So institute volunteered to that it need to be expanded and give the services and type of things. Anyway, so this about the things which is pretty known, rather these are things which are there. Now if we go if we look at the whole, try to look at the whole cloud ecosystem. So why I am telling ecosystem, because only cloud there are a lot of challenges, huh? One of the major challenges is that continuous connectivity, right? Another things becomes that things may be pretty useful, or I may want to use when for some say in case of disaster management and etc. Like as if you see that this during your the cyclone or Amphan, right? This what happened that they want to know that what is the movement of the things cyclone, and not only that there are how much of the land is being affected, which are the things are getting affected, what is the population base out there, whether there is a permanent infrastructure or not where people can take shelter, and post cyclone they want to quickly assess that how much how to which are the roads which are still motorable, if it is if there are high building, how many people are there, etc. So now we see what we require for all those things is a always connectivity type of things. Cloud, first of all, require your connectivity is there, all the things. Secondly, what we see that this sort of data, as we'll see some of the things in shortly, these of the data are a huge volume in size, right? So it meteorological data or geospatial data or what we say remote sensing data, whatever seen from the Earth surface, these are huge voluminous data. Means often go for not only terabytes, is go to means terabytes to petabytes type of things when you try to churn a huge volume of data. So now this sort of data being pumped into the cloud require a bandwidth. Even if you don't go for that petabyte or terabyte type of data, even if there is a huge volume of data in a thing, then it will be a huge problematic in having this network bandwidth in place. So what will happen, there will be a crunch of the things. But see, why we are pumping to the cloud? We are pumping to the cloud because what we believe that we will have a good analytics out of here. I want to find out, say pushing this COVID related data, I want to do and want to find out, say, what is the scenario or what is the next possible containment zone or micro containment zone and type of things, whether there is a trend of migration of this micro containment zone, etc. So I want all data and see with the location, etc., how things are there and things like that, right? Now, so it is a processing huge data in a data center is one of the major challenge in case of a cloud. Data center may be privately hosted by organization, private cloud setup, or publicly available by paying rent, etc. Public, like Megamala is a private cloud, or public cloud like Amazon, Google, Azure, Salesforce, and other things. Sorry. So all necessary information has to be uploaded to the cloud for processing and extracting knowledge from it. First of all data should travel to the cloud in doing so. Suppose you have a lab and you want to monitor the temperature of the lab, right? Especially when it is unmanned, right? Maybe at the night, etc. You cannot switch off the lab. Some work is going on and type of things, it becomes more complex if you have more than one level to go together, right? Like as you are telling computer center, I think there are around small big around 10 such labs, some are core systems, some networking guys, etc., where things cannot be stopped, so it is running round the clock. What they want to maintain very meticulously, other than the power supply, which is more standardized to maintain, is the AC and the humidity, right? And there is a quite balance out of it. Otherwise, there are difficult problems. Those who are used to maintain this large scale or data center type of things. First of all, if the humidity is high, temperature high, there may be a formation of ice, and that in turn block your vent of the AC and may sometimes create another temperature rise, which may spill into water. This practically have happened to our Megamala infrastructure. So one day security called up that a routine thing, they found there are water falling on the infrastructure. So there is a high precision AC and humidity has gone up, and then it created all those things. We are just wondering that what happened. So what we require is a monitor. So best thing is that I have a bunch of sensors which sense the data and maybe all the things, push it to the some centralized infrastructure for our things to the Megamala cloud itself or maybe Amazon cloud, where I have a nice algorithms which are very within more than this or other labs within comparison of that, if it's centralized AC within the comparison with the other labs, whether the temperature variation is more than 20%, then triggered some alarm and etc., right? Now you see, this whole thing, if there is a little bit of computing facility, I could have done locally, right? Instead of pushing it all through the Amazon cloud or even Megamola cloud, I could have done locally, right? So this gives an idea that whether this computing business can be brought down to some little locally doing the things, right? Right. So that being say things that there are challenges with a cloud only computing. Like communication takes long time due to humans, smartphone in type of interaction at times. Data center are centralized, so the all data from different region cause congestion in the core network. It may happen. Such task requires very low response time. Some of the tasks to prevent further crash and thing, there is a accident. So what we require, suppose the accident happened in Pune or in Chennai, then pushing to a data into a server which is lying in Singapore or in North America, it may not be so much required. No, 1 minute, right? So so what I require, if there is an accident, I want to basically send a alert across this traffic lights or something to detouring or traffic personals or traffic police, that you start detouring. You don't pump traffic into the things. Maybe you put all these red, etc. at different level so that it goes on routing. Otherwise, people will bump into this, right? This may be a main arterial road and people will go on pushing, coming into the thing. For that, that this could have been done locally, even some computing facility available with the nearby traffic light system could have done this calculation, that suddenly there is a lot of influx into the traffic, but there is no traffic at this end, no traffic recognized by the thing, and so it triggers that in this segment of the road there may be a accident, right? Or something goes wrong which has blocked the road. So immediately make a buffer and do some operations which is needed, right? Which could have been done locally instead of pushing all the things to the things, which may take a much more time, or sometimes the connectivity loss, etc., will create problem. So this fully cloud compute cloud only solution may not be the thing. So this gave rise to another paradigm, what we look at the fog, or what we say fogging, sometimes interchangeably used with edge computing, though there is a good amount of people argue that fog and edge should not be placed at the things, but edge is more towards the edge of the things. So a model where data processing application are concentrated in device on the network edge rather than existing almost entirely centralized in the cloud. Right? So this is pushing the whole thing into the edge. Now, that the term fog computing was introduced by Cisco. So Cisco is a network giant, as we know, and Cisco has another challenge because of huge deployments of these network devices, and these devices are becoming day-to-day more resourceful, intelligent, and doing processing. Like nowadays, you get not only Cisco, Juniper and other things also come up the things. So they, you have switches which are even layer 7 enabled. Means they can do content filtering, content-based some filtering and decision making and type of things, right? So these are enormously resourceful things, right? As Cisco has a large installation and their resources are pretty high on standard, what they found that most of the resources are lying idle at majority of the time, which could have been used for some other purpose. So why not allow some sort of a computation on the things? So they termed as a fog computing, a new model to ease wireless data transfer to distributed devices in an IoT network paradigm. So this become more challenging when we have Internet of Things or IoT paradigm, where there is a lot of pump to the data, which are over the wireless medium, which are again bandwidth hungry things, right? So Cisco's vision of fog computing is to enable application on billions of connected devices to run directly at the network edges. As Cisco has a huge infrastructure, things are like. User can develop, manage, run software application on Cisco framework of network devices, including hardening routers, switches, etc. Those who worked on router hardening, etc., that you can, you have the that Cisco operating system. So not only Cisco, as I'm repeating, all other things are having their own operating system. Cisco, they call it, I think, Cisco iOS, where you can have different type of resources, right? Cisco brings the open source Linux and operating system together to a single network product. Nevertheless, this has make a different paradigm altogether. That means I have a cloud at the top. Now I have something on the edge, so I can do compute something, and then I can push it to the cloud, right? Or even I can the end result, I can push it to the cloud. Some of the things could have resolved at the fog environment itself. Like if I consider this our room temperature related paradigm, I could have done that at the lab level itself instead of pushing it to the things. It may be a Cisco device or it may be a dedicated computing device which basically takes this data, a dedicated or shared computing device. Even it can be a smartphone, right? Nowadays smartphone are having much more resources than maybe the things. My laptop that I am now presenting is a 8GB system, but my son is having a phone which is my laptop is a 4GB system, and my son is having a phone which is 8GB memory, right? So ideally it has a lot of resources to do compute, but anyway, we are not trying to compare, but nevertheless there is a things. But it comes with several challenges, right? Now how much do I compute at the down the line, right? How, what I should compute here, what I should push it to the things. Some of the things I can't do, right? Like if I want to do is a nationwide COVID management type of things, then I cannot do with the only the FOC devices. So that can be something at the low edge, something at the cloud level. And the term is also quite justified. So cloud at much higher level, and then we bring down this computing a little lower in the, more towards the ground, is what we say, FOC. So this pictorially if we see, so these are my different devices, or what we say, different sensory devices, which can communicate to some FOC, or I can even think of that there will be some smart device down the line. These days, these cars are becoming more smarter, which is more of a having more electronics than mechanical electronics, somebody is saying. And not only that, they have something called what they called is in the VANET term is OBU, onboard unit, onboard computing unit, where you can have a good amount of resource. And there are other devices also, like starting from camera or laptop or tab or mobile devices, which directly collects. Actually, I can, if we consider these as we many people consider as edges, so there down the line there can be different sensors. Either this fellow is having sensors, or some of the sensors are communicating with this, right? In case of a cloud, in case of a car, there may be a accident sensor and a different type of sensors which can communicate, which takes a call in between and then takes a call, right? You might have that worked on vehicular ad hoc network and type of things. And not only that, there are different standards nowadays which are coming up, which are being followed by different things. Especially there are several safety standard. If the car is in accident, then they transmit that, they say it is a post crash notification, PCN alerts. Right, once it is crashed, it will go on doing this post-crash notification. And suddenly, if there is an accident, it follows by the car which slows down, right? So nearby car slows down, whereas at the end, the cars are still at far end or far back, the cars are still does not know that what is the thing. So that goes for a SVA type of alert, slow vehicle alert or something they say. So that in turn, so these are the sensors of the card which are basically sending information to the things, which in turn can take a call out here, or it wants to take a call of the nearby regions, whether there is an accident, whether there is a detouring is required. Then there can be a fork device which can be your this toll plaza, or it can be somewhere your street light system, etc. Or it can become dedicated, what they say, in case of vehicular ad hoc network, the roadside units, RSUs, right? So there can be RSUs where it can take a call, right? And this will be extremely helpful if you see in a city life like Kolkata or any major cities. It may not be very great helpful for helpful for city in our in Kharagpur, where we do not have much traffic at our place, and but whereas that in city there is this type of deduit. So this fog application can take a call, and where I can have different intelligent applications, right, based on that camera catching the movement of the traffic and or counting the amount of volume of things. I can do lot of things. So there are bring intelligence down to the cloud, to the ground, to the end user, right? It is bringing the towards more the things. Cellular base station, network router, Wi-Fi gateway will be capable of running applications, right? End devices like sensors are able to have basic data processing or data things, processing of the close to the devices, lower the response time, enabling real-time application, etc. One part later on, or rather people say, this also give a sense of security, right? Like I may not want to give all my data somewhere in the cloud, etc., whether I want to do something which is locally doing the processing the things. Okay, so that also what we try to look at, the cloud is enable a transaction and resources at the edge of the cloud, rather than enabling challenge for the edge of the cloud, which are the cloud storage and utilization. Reduce a need for bandwidth by not sending every bit of information to the cloud. And it's a some sort of a distributed strategy, right? Once this distributed strategy comes into play, then a lot of other things comes into play, specifically the resource management. How much I can leverage on the specifically two couple of things. One is the definitely the resource management. Another also, which may not be immediately operational in need, but there is a security type of things. Who is allowed to see what sort of data at what level, right? So anyway, resource management is a big challenge. What amount I want to go to the fork, and how much I want to push a cloud. And that may not be a one-to-one relationship. I can have a fog network out here itself, which even can have a something like fog network for transportation, fog network for medical type of thing. So I can have different sort of stuff into the things, right? So this creates a network. Even if you those who are read this Vane things or Vane standard, even several companies, especially the large card giants, they are creating like Ford or something, they are creating a want to create a network which is mainly their car. But now things are in a standard, they can exchange the thing. So a couple of Ford card can communicate and do some message exchange, right? So this type of things are possible. So there are other way of the things. I can have different sensors, mobile device, in between some clock device, which can be a gateway type of things, or it can be any notebook or desktop and sort of things which can be used. And at the end, I can push it to the cloud, which is far end, even in a different continent itself, right? So definitely who are the main enabler? Virtualization is definitely one of the major player or major what we say prime mover, and it is also, as in case of fog also, in case of cloud also. There is another things what you are definitely gone through is the container service or containers or Docker services, right? So reduce the overhead of resource management by using lightweight virtualization thing. So it is a, as the term, we in some other occasion we can discuss little more on this container service. But the idea is that it is a self-contained type of things, right? It comes from a concept of like in the if you when we are shipping something through through ships and type of things, what we do, there are large containers which are being carried by trucks and then put on the these vessels and which carry the things. What they look at the things, they are not looking at the what is the inside, right? It is inside is basically everything contained into the things. They are looking at that the size, weight, and the overall things, whether they're fitting into the things, right? And the inside that things may be some legal authority, etc. So now it gives a idea or has a thing like it's a lightweight virtualization. So I can have a whole thing into a virtualized into a Docker container and can be transported in other end and can work on the things, right? So that is one things which is again this fog, one of the fog enabler. Definitely service oriented architecture as in case of a cloud, and also the software defined networking. So these are given us a ample opportunity to work on this type of fog type of computing. But definitely in doing so, if I meant that it is a going to be replaced cloud, no, not at all. It is that are to help cloud data center to prepare better response real time. Handshaking among fog and cloud is a main objective of the whole thing. So as I am telling, resource management or resource pooling, etc., or how things will be managed, things are there. So broadly benefits, there are low latency, widespread geographical mobility, very large number of nodes can be deployed, and I can provision, even I can have what we say volunteered services in case of, especially in case of catastrophe, we can request if there is a provision of looking like if you see, it is not a, I should not say it is a fog computing, but say the apps like Arogya Setu, etc., is a volunteer services, like you are doing something or allowing your system to do compute for a larger national or international cause, right? So the app is able to collect information, do something, it gives some information to you also, share at the other end. So it is something which is much nearer, and it is doing something which is at least locally, not all locally, but at least doing your, taking your coordinate, if something it received a nearby coordinate, then alarming you that within the things. So this sort of apps allows you, this sort of things allows you to have, and see the number of node can be exponentially, or if not always exponentially, can be largely increased even with participatory type of things, right? So rather there is a separate study or field of study called participatory sensing, which is also gaining a lot of popularity. So and predominant role in wireless accesses, strong presence in streaming and real-time applications, right, in case of a streaming, and there is a heterogeneous type of devices can be accommodated. So there are definitely a lot of motivations instead of going to the things. So there are, these are some of the major limitations or challenges, I should say, in the cloud, and fog tried to address some of these challenges, right? But if you look at overall things, like these are some of the comparing things, and can be some places you feel that we are pushing to the fog, but it is not like that. It is trying to have a companion paradigm or companion technology to the cloud. That's why I'm telling that these are all in the overall cloud computing ecosystem, right? So cloud ecosystem, right? So there are several sort of what we say complementary advantages, or in some cases disadvantages also. So there, if you see, there are several use cases, like for computing use cases. One is emergency evacuation systems. This is their natural resource disasters management stuff. These are also are very much that in case of natural disasters and things like that. Even what I heard from of one a senior scientist from meteorological department, even they, the in case of cyclone formation, etc., may not be in our country always, they even throw several sensors which are having some of them access in cluster type of things which collect informations along the cyclone, especially before it hit, to actually calculate the actual parameters regarding that cyclone formation or movement pattern, etc. And with this omnipresent IoT, it becomes a big uses, because that is a huge amount of sensory things, and especially now this drone, etc., on the picture, like people are saying that by 2025, maybe little here and there, that everybody, like now having that everybody has a mobile device in his pocket, in his or her pocket, or even bags, you say, that everybody will have a, what they say, that eye on the sky. So you, by another 3 to 5 years time, everybody will have a drone to see that what is there. You want to visit a place, you want to just check that how much, whether the particular shop is open or etc. So what becomes that huge volume of data need to be accumulated, processed, and some decision, which may be as low as if then else, to some complicated machine learning or deep learning algorithm should run on the place. So this, there are several applicability, like in case of a things like in different, this is the DC generic multi-stage architecture, and where we have different this IoT devices, where this especially collecting data processing at the fog level may be much useful. Smart grid and things like that, and as we said, there intelligent traffic lighting and sort of things, not exactly they say call as fog, but nowadays slowly changing. What we not our department, that there is a infrastructure, and that is traffic engineering department. We are having one project with Calcutta traffic, that how this your traffic light should change. Like means that means if there is a huge, whether it is a fixed amount of time red, green, blue, or it varies with based on the traffic, because nowadays all cameras are there, though totally recognizing a particular object may be a still a challenge based on the camera angle, etc., but counting objects are more or less now very standardized within a very plus minus errors. So if there is a count is there, so based on that, whether I can have this traffic lighting into the place. Not only that, like other in several countries, whether they are trying to make that, whether it makes sense to make a bus lane and type of things, right? Nowadays you'd see that in some places they want to make a bus lane. That means that lane is only for public transport, buses and other type of public transport, in the sense large public transports, which will allow traffic to movement. Anyway, for all those things, they require a statistics about the traffic and want to do some analysis on the fly, right? More or less on the fly. So that some sort of things what we are working with roadside units, etc. Just to give an idea, so we recently work on a couple of our students work, primarily a tech fellow, work on a fog computing of Internet of Health things, right? What we see that nowadays, especially we wanted to leverage on this or trying to have a some solution for something. Especially we started with old age people and always support, human support may not be possible. So how to have some sort of a information gathering for the things, right? Like if a old couple or something, they are staying alone, or a single person staying alone. So whether I can have, with a basic minimum thing, can collect some information and put an alert to his or her relatives, or maybe to the medical authority, what they are, medical centers where they are registered, and type of things. So what we see, these are some of the things which are at the edges, like devices which can collect information, and then we can have some of the fog units. Like fog units, in the sense, we can have some devices, even our mobile device can also act as a fog devices, which basically process and see that if the some parameters are misbehaving, like if I say blood pressure, pulse rate, and etc., etc., and some of them are, if a functional of this, it is definitely require a medical expert comment. So if I can do a functional model and say, see, this requires a attention, right? So it can be alerted. I can alert a nearby medical health center or his or her relatives that this needs some intervention. Along with that, we can do other things, like I can, if there is a provision of closed circuit camera, etc., we can basically trigger those camera. These are done locally. If I want to push this thing, whole thing, to an Amazon cloud, which is lying in somewhere in, say, as I'm telling, that New York or Singapore, and then comes back, not only delay, it requires a lot of bandwidth, cost goes up, and type of things. So we tried to set a framework where this sort of things will be there. So we have fog limitation, fog architecture, and latency, suppose, or whatever we discussed. So want to do a type of things. Not only that, we tried to modulate. We made actually some of the devices which is a hand driven, which will collect your pulse and heart rate and etc., whatever we get standard. Along with that, we connected a that SpO2. Nowadays, very due to COVID, it is very at every home we are having those things. So it's a SpO2 or your saturation, oxygen saturation measurement unit, and those with a connected with this band, and then whether I can communicate with a mobile device and take a thing, right? So even it is helpful for COVID centers where home quarantine or stay safe home or type of things are there. So these are that can be made to use, not only COVID, any type of scenarios. So we did that. There are different sensors, and there can be some display unit also. So I use mobile devices as the this layer. Then we have a gateway which is there, and then we have things like level 1, level 2 cloud, like that, right? So rather, this is we implemented and tested using some as you see the picture, using some customized sensor which are easily available, uses a Raspberry Pi as a fog device to do an AWS cloud and communicate it and give back that alert and type of things. And there is something which this was alert was related that you are need to visit. This is a something to do with heart days, means heart related problems and type of things. Rather, we simulated. Rather, many of you might have used a iFoxSim. That is a very popular simulator, which was jointly developed by our team at IIT Kharagpur, and we have a collaboration of Professor Rajkumar Bua at University of Melbourne. So it was developed by here two students, and there was also things. So we collaboratively developed. So it is a iFox simulator, which we simulated with a cloud sim, and now actually we showed using a thing it works, right? But it in make it to work things we require more large scale deployment and type of things, right? So in this connection, before we end this part, there is another concept which is growing up in the things is a DEW, or there is a concept called DEW computing or DEW server. A little bit pushing again more below fog. The idea is that your connectivity may not be always on, right? So whether I require some a more nearer services other than fog, which can consume these and have sync with the cloud server as and when required, right? So again, fog device, whatever it is doing the things, but it requires a connectivity. If it is not there, it will pump it to some sort of a due server or set of servers, or I can say due network, and which is going on, which is again a new type of concepts or things which is coming up, right? So with this, we'll try to wrap up this our initial part. I will not take much time, but we'll have some little view or some little concept on our this special cloud computing or special cloud, right? Then we'll take up some questions if you are having, right? That should be fine. Okay. So just to, as I mentioned, that we work largely on spatial data science and also try to look on spatial data science with cloud and other things. So what this tells us, this spatial cloud, what is spatial data or what is this all about? Now, if you look at the spatial data, let me put it more. So anything which is you can see by some sensor or by your eyes, a data which is there, or by some sensors, right? So the best way we primarily work on geospatial data sets. That means data which is related to Earth surface, data having some coordinate inbuilt into the things. You may call that this is my one legacy that I worked on ISRO with remote sensing and GIS on large scale data sets. These data sets is primarily huge in size, extremely huge in size, right? And anything doing meaningful is very, very difficult, right? I'll give you an idea, or some of you already might have worked, with our own satellite system, IRS, Indian Remote Sensing Satellite. If you take a picture of, say, Jadavpur University, Salt Lake campus, so the typical picture size or the snap size is around 5,000 cross 7,000 matrix with minimum 8 layers. There are, or what we say, minimum 8 spectral resolution. These days we are having around 200 layers also, all hyperspectral band, etc. So it's doing anything meaningful is a huge volume of data. And usually, sometimes will happen that you cannot get the data in one particular snap, rather you require multiple snap to stitch together and becomes a different ballgame. So it is always makes sense that if you have a how to handle this, so it's a big challenge, and where we are also leveraging on cloud, fog and type of things. Those spatial data also extend anything which can be referenced with a reference system, right? Even a body, organs, etc. So if we have a body reference system, with respect to that, I can say kidney placement is there, or heart is here, something, eye is there, and type of thing. And even if I go for MRI images, etc., with respect to a reference system, or so to say graph paper, I can say that if this is there, that will be there, that medical expertise is required. That is also a special thing. But when we are working mostly on, or mostly not, purely on geospatial data, the data which is on the seen on the Earth surface. The challenge is the data volume is large, and data has different manifestation at different scale. Like if you look at a building of, say, IT department building in Jadavpur University, Salt Lake campus, if you fly a drone 50 meter above, you will see the data as a polygon, right? So some combination of different rectangle, it's a polygon. Now if you put that, take it that things from a airplane, then it may be a point, right? This building may be a point. At some scale, you may not see the building itself, right? Or what we say that it have different manifestations. Sometimes it's a point, sometimes it is a polygon, right? Road, when we calculate the distance between, say, JU IT department and IIT Kharagpur CS department, then we consider this road as a line. But suppose I want to expand the load, then it's become a polygon, right? It's a area which need to be expanded and type of things, right? making lanes and adjusting. So it has different manifestation and things, and data is huge volume. Like one of the best example of different location based service we are using is maybe the Google Map or any other maps which Map My India or something, which allows you to find different location based services, starting from shortest distance to where is the nearby restaurant or petrol pump or etc. etc. So this makes a lot of sense when you deal with the spatial data, and specifically it makes more challenging when you need to churn or do different type of algorithm over it. So what we say spatial analytics, where it becomes a huge challenge, and we may leverage on a computing platform, right? So this cloud may be a good thing to look at, right? So cloud computing refers to the spatial cloud computing refers to a paradigm driven by geospatial science, optimized by spatio-temporal principles, or enabling geospatial science discoveries, cloud and cloud computing distributed thing. The problem is this data sometimes changes over time. Right, if I say the traffic scenario in nearby, say in Salt Lake or in Kolkata, so the scenario changes over the time span, right? Some of the things change that rapidly with time. Like if I say that build up area, the buildings in Kolkata or in Salt Lake, it is not that volatile, or it is not that mutable, right? So the buildings which are there, it takes time of changing the over time, right? Some of that very volatile, and that means always changing of the things, and that becomes very tricky to work on those data. So I will show you a couple of slides before we end. It is in another PPT. I'm just closing that and opening the other thing. I didn't copy it here, right? So as we are discussing, when we talk about spatial analytics, it's a location oriented problem, better understood where and what is occurring around the world, right? Or around ourselves, right? Is gone beyond mapping and let us study the characteristics of places, relationship between them. And what you see that it has been reported more than 90% of all data sets across the world, if not more percentage wise, have some spatial context, has some spatial thing into this. Even if you see that how we are having this discussion over the net, even when we are connecting, if you want to make a statistics or a data set that who are participated and who are the speakers and who are the organizers, etc., everybody has a location when they are thing, everybody has a address which is a location, everybody belongs to an institute or organization or something, etc., which has a location, right? So it is a location is something inbuilt to our day-to-day or our human life. So spatial analysis tends to new perspective of any decision making. So we have to find out that some whether new perspective is there. Some of the slide will show that where we do about the movement dynamics, right? Like typically human move for a with a intent, right? There is an intention of the movement, right? So if we like even within your institute or within say Salt Lake or within your within a particular region, so there is a movement which is human movement with the intent. Now if we collectively do, if not individually, then whether I can look at the intent, something we naturally we capture over time, we learned over time. Like we say that don't go out at this time, there would be lot of crowd in that particular lane, better you use this lane to go into the things, right? And things like that. So it is a Sunday, you can basically now use this lane, even that it is other day it is crowded, today it will be no school, etc., right? So there will be no good. So these some of the things we learn, some of the things we naturally don't learn. Especially cities like Kolkata, Mumbai, etc., where there is a huge influx now due to COVID, that type of things are not there. A huge influx of population during morning hours, and that goes out during evening hours, right? The whole city dynamics goes for a spin when it comes and go then. And if there is any catastrophe, anything like accident, road blockade, or heavy rain, etc., then it becomes a more tricky scenario to manage traffic, etc., and you require very experienced people to work on. Anyway, so whether the spatial analytics can help us, right? So I need to identify that which are my things required, because they're huge data sets, and then I need to analyze, then I need to draw inference and may give a feedback to the organization and people at large, right? So spatial lets you pose question and derive answer. It is used by people to world to derive new information and things. Like like things like want to look at a crime studies. That is a crime studies means Bombay police use, Calcutta police also trying that whether there is a crime hotspot. They have some knowledge, but whether looking at this crime spot, crime reporting things, whether there are crime hotspot, because number of police personnel is much less than the whole area into the which they need to cover, right? And always there is always a challenge to handle. So how the police patrolling will do, if something goes wrong, what are the possible areas by which criminals, so-called criminals or so-called antisocials are likely to move. So where I need to put the traffic, etc. So there may be things, analyzing drought or heavy flooding, etc. There is another major challenge which people want to look at, right? Looking at things, and especially if there are flash, sudden events like cyclone, etc., there is a major challenge. Finding optimal path is our day-to-day things, right? Going from, say, your campus to Jadavpur main campus, you need to think twice that what is the time of the day, whether there is a procession or not, and etc., etc., type of whether it is a weekday or a working day, and find a path, right? Google helps you in doing so, but sometimes we may need something more, the things like, because of I want to do analysis and plan something a priori and look at the things, then I can have different type of prediction, starting from all those are different type of prediction model, forecasting model you want to look at. Here, where this cloud computing, so first of all, volumeous spatial temporal instances, integration of heterogeneous data sets, that is where it's there. Now, data is not with the things, like even if you want to look at finding the shortest path or least congested path between Jadavpur main campus and Salt Lake campus. So what you want to do, we want to look at the road network, which may be the custodian, may be the transport authority. You want to know that what is the traffic on the road, which may be the traffic auto, your Calcutta police may be the custodian of the data. You may want to know that whether there is a procession, or maybe there is some puja or some religious things. But you want to know that in between, there may be a cultural department or some other things may be doing other things, and if there are that, they may have the meet of things. So different authorities or states need to work with the this sort of scenarios, right? You need to get the end scale. So it should support discovery, access, utilization of the data. Provide, you have to pull that IT resources, like either you have your standard or your laptop is powerful enough to do that, or you have to do, or even even everybody agrees to share the data, you find it difficult that if you get all those data, how do I do that? You, what we'll do, we'll go to the Google Map. Suppose they say that, oh, whatever data you want, just give us a call, we'll, and give us a location, I will just put on the data set, or you pull the data from here, right? And there can be, you need to deal with access spike. Suddenly everybody wants more data. If it is evening time, if afternoon time may not be that requirement. Provide more reliable and scalable service for massive number concurrent user to advance public knowledge, etc., etc. So I require some of the things which like as a say Calcutta police, if there is some incidents, water logging, etc., they want to make immediate analysis of the things with their what we say domain knowledge, and want to send it through SMS or through some social media and type of tweet or Facebook, etc., and say that this area is totally waterlogged, don't come into the things, right? Like your Science City crossing is now inaccessible and any traffic should not come, right? So that, so things will be there. So cloud computing, so it models, as we have seen, this is the thing which may be a good way of looking at the things, right? So this spatial analytics plus cloud may help us in doing this type of things. So this is, again, we are not going to the things. So these are some of the things which are advantage of the cloud computing. And what we look at, as everything goes as a service, right? So there, here also, we look at whether I can have different type of services. Like one is that service is an infrastructure, PaaS, and software as a service. Or as the storage is one of the major challenges, yeah, storage as a service. But how do I access it? Suppose Google is giving these maps, etc. How do I access it, right? So if we look at the spatial time, what you require? Most of the time, we require some sort of display online. Right, not always. So what we require is a web map service, right? There are other things which require a processing services. I want to process some data and do on the things. I require some of the things which is I want to extract some data and get the things. Now those data may be in some, they are proprietary database, and when I access that, I want to put in something standard database, Oracle or MySQL, etc. So I want that data to be exported to me in some sort of a XML form, so that I, with a XML schema, of course, so that I can push it into my database. So these are the web feature service. And of course, where do I find the data? Whether I require this, say, 4-5 set of data, where do I find this data? For that, I require some catalog or registry service where I can have these services, right? So I want to discover, I may want to display a map, I want to process all those things. This may be a ideal scenario for this spatial cloud. What Google is doing, they are using, they are leveraging on their own cloud systems, which they have a huge infrastructures across the world, and they, not only that, there are several organizations which deals with this sort of data, which leverage other cloud like AWS and type of things, right? So this is maybe a typical architecture. I am not going deep into the things. So I have what is the name? OGC, Open Geospatial Consortium. Like we have ISO, we have IEEE standards. So that this network data being shared, one router of one make, other router of other switch of other make, they can talk to each other. Like that, there is a standard called Open Geospatial Consortium. They come with OGC standard, where all country are member of that thing, and all major players, starting from Oracle to Google to all major players who deals with data, are member of the thing, so that everybody follows that different type of standards, right? So, and that comes with the standard for that of how web feature service, map service, processing service will look like, and how this registry service should be there, so that we follow. And as this is becoming hugely useful and popular, you will see that Oracle database came up with the version, or now the newer version of Oracle, or not newer, when it was there for last one decade or so, they have a spatial extension. That means I can't do some other occasion we'll discuss with the spatial data. So I can do our traditional DBMS, store this spatial data. It will be huge time consuming. So I require a spatial extension of this database, right? So spatial data and type of things, right? So this is Oracle Spatial. Like that, Postgres has a spatial extension. I think MySQL is also working on it, and things like that, right? So this sort of thing, I have a web registry, I can deploy these different type of things. There is a concept called spatial data infrastructure, we in India also we are having a national spatial data infrastructure, which is a sort of a crude term, we say that it acts as a broker for all spatial data to be accessed. So it is growing up, but in countries like US or in even Europe or Canada, they have very strong NSDI. So any type of data you require, you can hook to that NSDI. Definitely there are access control mechanism, not that all will see all the data, but if you are allowed to see the data, you can access and work on those data sets, right? So in India also that type of NSDI is there, which is maintained by Department of Science and Technology, a wing under Department of Science and Technology. So the it requires for a particular component, which is data or services, and it looks as a registry whether that is there, and it hooks into those data set and gets a thing. So, and creates the instance in the cloud, right? So that creates our whole story. So this one work we do very extensively is that mobility analysis, which is utilize cloud platform for computation of the things. Find out the mobility of different things, starting from human, taxi trajectory, etc. is being hugely studied across the world, especially in the cities, because it this urbanization, what report of United Nations say that by 2030, maybe due to COVID, there may be 1 year here and there. By their report says that by 2030, 70% of world population will move towards urbanization, right? In other sense, either the things will become urban or there will be a lot of populations out there. And then there is a need of overall finding this mobility analytics, starting from this to even these are useful for mobility analytics of finding natural phenomena, like how, like if you we know that there are a lot of problems of elephant herd movements in places like Purulia, Bankura districts and type of things. So whether that is random or there is a something is there. There is a definitely human-animal conflict. There are existing animal corridor which we might have blocked and used for some other purpose. But over the years, whether that movement pattern is changing, whether I can do a priori type of things, and even mobility of different phenomena, etc., are important. And it's a largely traffic. So what do we work on? That a trajectory trace mining of smart city applications. So whether I can map trajectory data for having a in the smart city. So it mobility dynamics is connected mobility knowledge based on people point of interest and cities, how they concentrate, individual activity, social event, regional semantics, city dynamics, whether they contribute into the things. So it is information processing and things. Now we based on things, I want to have data acquisition and storage, and then I do want to do analytics. Now these data have different periodicity of that collection also. Some are you may want to collect the data every hour, or some every minute, some are maybe every daily basis, and it needs to be stored and need to be analyzed based on the demand, right? So can be individual, aggregated, something contextual. If this happens, what else will happen? If there is a congestion, what else is likely to be there? Which is based on that, what is the traffic movement, etc. If the middle of the night, if there is a very low traffic movement, if there is a congestion, it doesn't matter much. But if it is something which is happening, say morning 10 o'clock or an evening or afternoon 2 o'clock or something, they have a different dynamics. So I need to immediately have something contextual, which some requires something, which require a some semantics of the overall doing. So this is one of the work we are doing. We are doing a lot of other type of things. So smart mobility, smart governance, smart environment, even quote unquote smart people movements and type of things. So in summary, I want to make a spatial data infrastructure with the intelligent framework to model city dynamics, effective storage and computational methods, learning dynamics, and so on and so forth. Right. So we do several, not only we, across the world, there are a lot of work, like one is the triage cloud, trying to look at the trajectory planning, that if I want to go from A to B, so how do I plan a priori, right? So on Google, I get instance, tenuous things, but I may not get other things like which may have other semantically true, like day, time of the day, day of a week and type of things. So I have a travel prediction, whether there is a ride sharing type of things which makes sense. So then some are what we look at special trajectory. There are some of the semantic trajectory, like human movement follows the intent. We did one study with IIT Kharagpur, different volunteers, like to categorize that student, say staff, faculty members, and guest who are not the things. Whether by that we can identify this particular person. Our intent was not to identify a or privacy intrusion of a person, but given a person, whether I say this is likely to be a student and type of things. This may be very helpful in different occasion, because that may help me in, definitely there are security implication, but that may help me in planning that what should be the traffic movement, right? Something which is inherent to it. Like if you tell me that now college is closed, institute is closed, but if you tell me that there is a meeting, usually we set the meeting if we don't have class, not at say 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, like that. We set usually half an hour here and there, 9:30, 10:30, because our this hourly basis, our classes are scheduled like 8 to 9, 9 to 10, 10 to 11. Now what happened if you are fall into the 9 o'clock? There is a lot of traffic on the road, people are moving here and there, students, etc. So better to shift somewhere in between where the roads are practically vacant, right? So you can just go on means any direction, any speed, anyway any speed is not allowed that is there. So this it's a trajectory cloud for enabling efficient mobility services. I am not going again details of the things, but it allows me to have a effective mobility services. So this was motivation, and we have a trash cloud. If you see, there are collecting different information. Some are GPS traces, POIs, the point of interest are not changing, so we can have a pseudo static. There are trajectory pre-processing, so cleaning of the data and building spatio-temporal indexes and type of things. And then we have trajectory data modeling, say map matching, trajectory state geotagging, trajectory storage, and trajectory state processing and type of things. And underlining, we are using Google Cloud Platform. Incidentally, Google Cloud Platform gives you a lot of tools and things to handle anything. So they have Cloud SQL, storage facility, there is of course the Google Compute Engine, BigQuery type of things. Even you can use like those of MapReduce type of scenarios, and so we are leveraging on GCP to work on the things and find out different type of operations, right? I'm not going again details. So these are some of the things which are having different point query, range query, which are run on this cloud platform. And we want to have cloud, fog, edge, that type of paradigm out here also, where user mobility along with moving vehicles, like user are in the vehicles working, etc., along with four devices as we have things, and want to look at a analytic framework for locator, right, which are which want to work on this based on the user movement, etc. We want to find out that where it is located, how much data it can. It is actually, it was meant our again for this ambulance, the type of things, like especially places which are villages, like we see around Kharagpur or in these places, a lot of traffic goes from here to Kolkata, right? Due to maybe may not be good medical facility around here, and most of the cases they have to run around different hospitals and type of thing. There are a lot of other dynamics, like it is not like that straightforward you can solve, but nevertheless, even looking at that different type of patient condition and type of things, if we have a way to communicate, suppose even if we have a contact with the hospital, so if we can have the basic data type of things, even it can say that the based on the criticality of the things, you may not able to travel you are not in a position to travel to Kolkata, you need to go to some health facility nearby because the condition of the things, right? So there can be different sort of things. So mobility aware internet of special things, what is what we broadly want to see, right? So as we have seen that internet of health things, extension of those things, we can have type of things, right? So there are there's a more broad picture. Again, I am not going into details of these things. So there are lot of ifs and many that can be a separate discussion altogether later on, right? So so based on the things, we can have different sort of a heat maps and things that where people accumulate at different portion of the time, and whether this is as I was telling you, that is with the academic performer groups, right? This was an interesting study we tried, that whether CGPA of the people has any relation of grouping of the people, right? Or like whether that there is a performance of the student has a mapping with the type of things. The study was not not very successful, not for the technological reason, but due to non-availability of data, right? Because we have a strong ERP system, but due to privacy protection, they don't want to share information without the consent, and several students have reservations. Again, we can't get much volunteers, though we have 10,000 odd students, we get hardly volunteers who ready to use our app and so share their locations, type of things like that. But that was interesting. But these all are processed on the back end to this Google Cloud. Rather, we have used Amazon Cloud, even worked on our Megamala. But Megamala being an infrastructure things, we need to load all possible services, whereas Google gives you a good platform to work on. But nevertheless, it is a good way of processing, and it has been shown that is a that especially volume of data analyzing etc. become much easier, much convenient if you have a cloud platform, right? So this is there, and not only that, if you look at the national scenario, this NSDI as we are talking of, they are now going to from the server mode to a cloud mode. So they have a pilot cloud study so that they can all states, all collaborating organizations can have their data and share. Definitely there are access control mechanisms in place, which is organization-wide, organization level control, and also there are role-based access control. Security is in place, but they found that doing server-based things, maintaining and scaling up resource management, etc., becoming a major challenge. They are working on a cloud platform. Our special data science lab is also a part of it, doing some experimentation to see that which will be suitable and not, those type of work. Okay, so I think let me stop here and take up some question, if any. Let me come back to my original thank you slide so that we can take up the question. So first of all, thanks to JU, especially JU IT department, and especially to Dr. Urpita Ray and faculty members and head of the IT department for this good opportunity to give you a talk, though it is short, but I think it will be good option to collaborate in future. So let me close this sharing so that I can come back to the things. Good, I'm back.
Thank you, sir, for such an interesting and informative talk. We'll have a very short question answer session. Right. So I have collected some questions from the YouTube link. So okay. The first question is, can you suggest some geospatial data repositories on which we can work on?
Yeah, right. So one of the data set freely available, incidentally, from our there are, when we talk about geospatial data, they are from the different type of data. One of the basic data set is of the satellite data, right? Satellite remote sensing data. Those who are not very accustomed, so satellite remote sensing data, there are two category of satellites system, right? One, what we look at, if we talk about our Indian satellite systems. So one is that INSAT category, which is meant for communication and weather, large scale weather forecasting, primarily for communication and other things, which is geostationary, just over our India, always over. Another is a remote sensing satellite, which basically moves on a lower orbit, typically 500 to 900 kilometer, typically 700 kilometers, say, and it moves in a polar in the sense pole to pole. So Earth is moving like this and it moves like this, so it all captures the thing. So these are the Indian remote sensing satellite. So these data set are extensively used for remote sensing analysis, and also you can derive for all geospatial. You can basically write to ISRO, they give. Otherwise, this is usually available from USGS, that is US NASA repository. They give regularly, if you academic purpose, they give free. Other than this type of data, what we did is some of the trajectory, some of the taxi data set, which are some of the things are freely available. Some data set of New York taxi trajectories are available. Some of the data sets are mobile data sets from some Nokia or something. Those are also freely available. You need to sign some agreement, but for academic purpose, it is freely available. And some of you, if you are interested, we do have some data set collected from these places. And also one source of data set we collect is voluntary, right? We like to, actually one interesting one, just to have a 1 minute thing, we want to do that, whether I can map a region based on the GPS footprint or locational. Suppose whether I can categorize the Jadavpur University different things, like which likely to be classroom, which is likely to be cafeteria, which is likely to be football ground or things, but without having the actual land use, land cover data, but having the mobility data, how people are moving, right? Because those are easy to get, but easy to get in the sense those are easily collected by the service provider, like your mobile service provider, but difficult to get because due to privacy restriction. So we did some study because we did some study with because one of my ex scholar is now in NIT Warangal, so he helped. So there are some volunteers from the students, they are movement and airborne. So we tried to that whether the movement pattern are matching from IIT Kharagpur and NIT Warangal, and whether if we say this is their movement is based on that, like everybody from the morning goes from hostel to class, there also it goes to the hostel to class. So by that we can identify this, which are the features, right? So to direct say your question, so one is that one we can say definitely from USGS, and there are open source sites. I can give some of the links and things. And otherwise, using voluntary things, these are not very difficult if you can get volunteers, right?
Okay, so the next question is, what is meant by spatio-temporal principles?
See, let me start with spatio-temporal data sets. That is understood, right? Which is change over space and time, right? Now, different data sets has different, feature sets, right? Suppose I say that, as I was still taking, that if I have data sets, spatial data sets of human movement, right? Or traffic movement in Kolkata or Salt Lake. So it is a spatio-temporal features. The way over space and time it is moving at some point of time on the day, it changes over time, right? Or it changes over the day of the weeks, days of the week, right? So there is, and they have some of the things may have different type of cycles. Right, if I say that your traffic light changing or traffic movement changing in some cycle, whereas traffic lane direction changing in some cycle, right? Whether there are different way of different manner they say. Now, how do I capture? So there should be some way of basic way of capturing these scenarios and make them into the things, right? Now, how do I map this data into my database? How do I analyze this data in through my in my database? Unless I put it, so I require some sort of a semantic knowledge along with this data set, which tries to capture this spatiotemporal behavior. There is a popular, not popular, what I say, there is a one way of looking at is what we say, it is a knowledge graph. So whether I can create a knowledge graph with the things. So when we talk about spatiotemporal principles, then whether I can have different sort of, whether I can have different type of principles which can be mapped into some way or another, it can be semantic graphs, it can be something which is very natural. I know those things. I know that how things will change because very periodic or very regulated way. So these things has to be properly leveraged upon to work on the actual data set. So I should have that which domain I am working, whether it is traffic domain. So there is a set of principles which it followed, which need to be mapped. If I am working on a natural disasters domain, that has to be there. If I am doing on a, say, something rainfall and water logging, etc. So that has a separate type of things. And number of cases, what have, that is underlining a physical phenomena also. It is not only things. We want to look at the things. So if we, again, look at the things, so these sort of things need to be captured in appropriate manner. Okay?
Thank you, sir. The last question is, if a VM in private cloud is using Google Cloud, will it be considered a hybrid cloud, the whole system?
Well, using Google Cloud is a little ambiguous. So one is, one in the sense that the VM in Megamala talking to a Google Cloud for some processing. Right. I take two scenarios. One is that there is a VM in the Megamala has to work on the Google Cloud in a some processing thing, right? Say I do some calculation, but when I work on the weather, I basically hook to the Google, get the things and get it back. So this is a service level interaction. So this this phenomena is ideally not a hybrid, right? So this is basically talking between two cloud service provider. But suppose in Megamala I have a VM. Now due to resource requirement, I want to leverage something with the Google. Like I expand the thing into the Google domain. At that point of time, I basically do a hybridization of the things, right? So I have, say, chunk of the things from my side, and my VM sometime allowed to migrate for the things to the Google or expand to the Google, right? So it can be a hybrid type of scenario. But saying so, in loose terms, if I have a federation, there is a what called Google 5, there is a what called Cloud Federation, as you, most of you must be knowing. So when I have different cloud provider federated to work together, right? If this federation is in a closed domain, like in a financial domain or working on the things, then some definition, I should say the word definition in some way of talking, I can say that is a hybridization of the things. This is a federation which gives me this solution, which is a hybrid cloud formation, right? But ideally, if I hybridization is that at the means basic SaaS, PaaS, IaaS level, I expand my services there seamlessly, as if I am working on the same thing, but I don't know which portion in the Google and which portion in the non-Google type of things, right? Okay.
Thank you, sir, for such an interesting and informative talk once again. Now I would like to invite Orpita Sarkar, Assistant Professor, Department of Mobile Computing and Communication, School of Mobile Computing and Communication, Jadavpur University, to give the vote of thanks. Madam, please.
A very good evening to all present in this webinar. It gives me an immense pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks for this event to all the dignitaries present here. I would like to thank our chief guest, Professor Chiranjeev Bhattacharya, ProVC Jadavpur University, who honored this event with his inspirational thoughts. I would like to thank our chief patron, Professor Krishnendu Chakravorty, Principal, Government College of Engineering and Ceramic Technology, for his enthusiastic speech for our participants. I would also like to thank our eminent speakers, Professor Shorbani Roy and Professor Shomukanti Ghosh, for their elaborate and informative talk. I would like to thank our director, School of Mobile Computing, Jadavpur University, for her cooperation in getting the webinar organized in a smooth way. I would like to thank Shupriyo and all the members of our organizing committee, all the participants from the various colleges and universities, and the audience for making this event a success. Once and all, I would like to thank one and all present here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. This concludes our webinar. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So I will take a leave. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.